Hello, Andrew. Hold on. I got a lot going on. There are things happening, sir.
Oh, I'm sorry. I mute it when I hear your music.
I don't blame you. I have terrible things.
You're very stretchy. You're in a... Am I watching a motion picture? Is this what this is?
Oh. I'm trying to find Chris's contact info.
He's adjusted.
Oh, wait, great. So I don't have to worry about that. All right, well, I tried calling Justin. Also, I am definitely whitening my teeth right now. So I sound like I have a retainer in my mouth. Oh, yeah. All right, well, I guess Justin will call in when he calls in. I'm going to go remove this crap from my stuff. Oh, heck yeah, Justin. Boodle-dee-doo-doo-doo-doo.
Skype's acting weird.
Yeah, it is. I'm going to leave the stream to you guys. I'm going to go take this crap off my teeth. I'm so glad that you reminded me about him being at Justin.
It's what I'm here for, Brian. To point out your failings. So, is there a stream here? Something? I don't know. I don't have any video from Brian, so all I see is my own face. I guess I could go to Diamond Club and see if there's a chat going on. It's one win. So, anyhow, this guy talking into a camera, no video feedback, so there could be nobody there. Everybody could be there. I really have no idea, guys. I got a chat window open over here. So there you have it. From my end, you just have to understand. I see nothing. I see nothing, guys. I'm in a void. I am trapped in a void. Just a textureless, formless, shapeless void with almost no light. But I know you're there. I feel your presence, guys. By the way, have you seen the new Poltergeist trailer? I'm not sure what to make of it. There's so many camera movements in it where it doesn't feel – it's weird. Like when you make a film and you have your camera move, you try to do things for different reasons. And in the case of this Poltergeist trailer, like I love the original Poltergeist. That was Tobe Hooper, you know, Texas Chainsaw Massacre directed it with Steven Spielberg literally like right over his shoulder. The new version is interesting. It's produced by Sam Raimi and his Ghost House Pictures. But in the trailer, you just see like the camera's just doing a lot of like, not like shaky cam, but like track shots and stuff like that, which to me maybe feels like in that trailer, it kills sort of the joy, or not the joy, but sort of the terror or the what makes it frightening, because you're actively aware that you're watching a movie as opposed to being present there. Just my take on it, guys. You know, I'm just a guy talking about Poltergeist, the remake. I have no problem with remakes at all. I think if you can bring something new and different to it. Very curious to see what's going to happen with the new Ghostbusters remake. You know, the idea of, you know, making it an all-female cast. They're all very funny. Wouldn't be the directionist. I think it's cool, the idea of having a, you know, all-girl Ghostbusters, I guess. But I want it to be about, you know, ghostbusting, you know. So we'll see. Anyhow, could be cool. I'm just a guy talking to a camera. That's all. Right now we're going to be covering we will be covering the SpaceX launch, which is going to be in 1 hour, 4 minutes from now. So we'll do it as a weird things or as an after things. Either way, we want to talk about this. We'll get Mr. Chris Taylor on board. He's the author of How Star Wars Conquered the Universe, and he will be casting live with Mr. Justin Robert Young.
Can you hear me?
I can hear you now, sir.
Cool. Yeah, we have me and Chris are here live on set.
Heck yes. Oh, wait.
That sounded like Brian. That did not sound like Chris at all. What are you guys trying to do? What are you trying to lie to me for?
I just realized, I guess I'll have to be good about switching to the one shot to get both of you guys in there.
Can I have video, please? Please, please, Brian, please.
You should have video.
I have no, now I have video.
Yeah. I'm just saying you should. I didn't say you did.
Yeah.
Okay. I was agreeing with you in principle. Okay.
Come on, push your chairs together, guys. You both have beards. What's the matter? Come on. It's the beard club.
Yeah, there we go.
Oh, and Justin's wearing man clothes. That's great.
Oh, so good. Chris, thank you so much for coming, man.
What was that? He was thanking you so much for coming while apparently walking away from the mic.
Yeah, no, that's how I do.
Hey, I'm like, thanks. Thanks a lot.
Anyway, it's great that you're on the show. Take care.
Thank you. Good night.
Dude, yeah. Okay, so I think I had another idea for, there was another two shot. I guess this is the only shot that.
Dude, this works. As long as we sound good, it's fine.
Okay. All right. Then good. Then let me. People are asking to get me live on the Alpha Geek Radio. Let me do that real fast. Do you guys know what channel we usually are on Alpha Geek Radio?
No idea.
Yeah. What's an Alpha Geek Radio?
It's a way for people to get the audio only. Two? People are saying two. Audio channel two. Nope, that can't be it because I don't have a saved password for that. So it's got to be three. Dude, there's a Diamond Club app for the
Roku
TV.
I know, I was reading that on Roku.
What? Wow. This is amazing. Okay. So let me do the butt thing. Thank you very much, Chris, for actually coming and being in studio. It's freaking rad.
Of course.
And hopefully we'll treat you right. Actually, I'm going to save it for the show. Alpha Geek 3, I guess, is what I'm doing.
Hey, Justin, how are you guys mic'd there?
We are on lavalier mics.
Okay.
How's my sound?
Yeah.
I can adjust the volume. Sure.
It's a bit harsh on our end.
You want me to turn it down?
Yeah, turn it down a touch, and then I could goose it on this end.
You got it.
People are saying check the schedule. Channel 3, got it. Neshcom says be mindful of the Skype ducking, fellas. That's a good point. Where is weird? Wait, there is no button for weird things on channel 3. It's only on channel 1. But I don't know if someone else is going.
So I'm going to ask you guys a question. Are we going to do the SpaceX launch as weird things or after things?
I think it should be after things, right?
Because we're already running.
Yeah, late. Well,
no, I'm saying like time-wise, we're already short.
If an hour for weird things, we would already be into the launch.
Okay, well then maybe we could switch over to the launch and make it part of the show, and then we'll just do after things as after things.
Perfect.
And in fact, depending on Chris's schedule, if he's interested in joining us for after things, I bet he'd have some pretty cool insights on the behind the scenes stuff. Hey guys, I'm sorry, there's no weird things button on Alpha Geek Radio Channel 3, so I guess I'm gonna hit. Channel 1, is anybody on live now that I would be booting off?
I don't know what any of that means. I don't need to know. I just don't know.
No, I guess, you know what? Maybe channel 2.
Wow. We just electrocute somebody?
Yeah, I don't know what that was.
Yeah, I think
that
happened.
I'm just going to skip. Ooh, nice. I'm going to skip Alpha Geek Radio altogether. Let me set levels and we'll just get started.
It's amazing how soothing the Star Wars logo is. All of a sudden it pops up like, relaxed.
Yes, exactly. Okay, so this is Brian Brushwood, and when I talk, I peek out at -6. Let me hear Justin.
Hey, I'm Justin. This is me talking. I'm going to talk like this and hopefully stay in frame.
That's great. Chris, can you say hello?
Hello, I'm Chris. I'm English originally, so I tend to speak quieter than
do you know what? Chris's audio is a bit muffled, like super bassy. I don't know exactly why. I could turn down the low end. I can you check and see if maybe you're sending over some overly bassed audio?
Right here. How's that? And I'll turn him. Anyway, keep talking. I'm going to keep talking like this. And
From both of you guys, it's pretty muddy. It's pretty bassy. I don't know if you're able to reduce that or not.
Do you just have like a desktop, like USB mic or something, or?
That's really weird because I just spent a half hour testing it out with.
I mean, you sound great, right? You sound great right now, Justin. You sound good enough. Yeah.
Well, Chris, can you keep going?
Sure.
Well, I mean, is Chris's microphone like on his shoulder there, or?
Yeah, I got it clipped on just.
There you go. Yeah, when you're speaking
directly into it, it's good.
just put it like right under the lapel there. Try or just like the closer it is to the center of your mouth. Put it in your mouth.
There you go. Just say the alphabet real quick for us.
B C D E F G H I J K L M N O P Q R S T U V W X Y Z.
Man, half of that sounded really good. The other half, it went all bassy on us again. Justin, can you, help him with the placement of that?
Yeah.
Shave the chest, tape it down.
Attach the electrodes.
Oh,
how's that?
Yeah, now we're talking.
All right.
Super. Okay. This is a special event for us, so I'm going to take a moment to tweet out, that we got you on the show.
So do we do this live? Does it get edited?
There'll be a live. Most people consume it as an audio podcast, so we'll be recording everything and we can tweak everything. But we also live stream it out to folks watching at diamondclub.tv.
All right, let's do it live.
Let's see. We're live now. And we are on diamondclub.tv chat room, if you guys could tell me. What's your Twitter handle, Chris?
Future Boy.
Future Boy? Oh, there it is, right there. Future Boy.
I like this.
Hey, goddamn, he ain't lying.
I like someone was writing there on the chat that I should clip it to the beard, which I'm sure that will be a thing, especially here in Oakland. Beard mics.
Awesome. Just so you guys know, if you see me doing this, it's because Chris's audio has gone a little bit muddy because I know you guys don't have any in studio monitors there. So if it starts to sound muddy, I'll just point here so that you know to speak into your communicator. Beauty. I'm ready to go when you guys are.
I'm ready, but I don't.
Yeah, let me turn off my phone.
Chris, do you live near Oakland?
I live in Berkeley. So yes.
Oh, Berkeley. Right on.
Just north.
That's great. Okay.
Chris, what's your title at Mashable?
Deputy Editor.
Okay.
Stop by again this year?
You know, we're definitely doing a thing. I don't know exactly what that thing is.
It's going to be the big Buffalo Billiards freak show like it has been in years past.
It will probably be that big. I don't know if we're going to do another Wrecking Ball or if we're probably not going to have Grumpy Cat this year.
That was an amazing year and really a statement on just civilization in general. When Elon Musk, I think it's funny that we're going to actually watch this launch today in real life, but. He was announcing the I believe the Grasshopper footage of them testing out those rockets, and the only thing anybody could talk about at South by Southwest where he announced that was the fact that they had gotten their picture taken next to Grumpy Cat at the Mashable party. It was,
she's a star.
Super fun.
She's a star.
Oh, dude, you can't dim that wattage. Like, it just, you know, it is unbeatable.
You know, I'm not one to kiss and tell, but I had intimate moments with Grumpy Cat.
How I feel like we've crossed the line.
hey, Justin, real quick, can you tap your mic just so I can verify that we're... Yeah, it's your audio. It sounds like I'm hearing you more on the other mic. If you could just goose up your mic back, then we're good.
Check.
Yeah, now we're hearing room tone from outside.
Check. 1, 2, 3.
You tell me, Andrew. How does it sound to you?
Not good.
It sounds like shit. That's Andrew. It sounds like shit face, but I don't want to say it because it's insulting Justin, who did work on something.
I'm just wondering, are we just better off with like a snowball or something sitting on the deck? I don't know. I'm just wondering if that might be better off that.
Yeah, it's everything sounds super room tony, unfortunately.
All right.
The problem I have with ears is like sometimes they're super directional, sometimes they're not. And then also you got Skype's, you know,
amplifying effect.
All right, just go ahead and do it.
Perfect. It's wonderful. Best waterfall sound I've heard all day. I'm looking at your Chris Taylor. As we mentioned before, you can follow him on Twitter at FutureBoy. He's got a who put the lightsabers on your avatar? That's wonderful.
Here, I'm following Chris right this minute, and I'm adding him to my homepage list. There we go. Oh, heck yeah.
And I all want you to know what the second most helpful review is on How Star Wars Conquered the Universe on Amazon.
Dagnabbit, I guess I'll tell you now. I was going to save it for the show. But to prep for this, to remind myself of all the different elements of the books, because it's been a month since I read it, I went to read Amazon reviews, and I read all the way through the review, and then I got to the last paragraph where it's like, here's my minor gripe. And I'm like, that sounds like a very specific minor gripe. And I scrolled all the way up to the top of the review. And I was like, God damn it, I just read Andrew's review.
Now I'm going to make Mr. Taylor watch a SpaceX launch.
That was a great review, Andrew. Thank you for that.
It's an amazing book. I've been using that as an example to other people about how to write biographical or nonfiction stuff is just, and I meant like for as, although I know Isaacson, who by the way, I was Ben Franklin bio here, which is great. And is for as disappointed as I was in his Jobs biography and covering that topic and that story, the way you handled this, I am a fan for life, sir. And I will click the buy button on whatever you want to do. I'm excited to see what you do next. You know, if you ever want to, I'm a best-selling author myself. If you ever want,
we're all in the same club here.
If you ever want an endorsement or, you know, anything, I'm there.
Nice. You haven't even started the interview.
Justin, can you tap the mic? I'm not hearing you on that mic. Yeah. I'm just saying
I'm a super fanboy. That's what I'm saying here. And all right. I'm saying that.
Thank you, Andrew.
All right, let me hear both you guys. Start with Justin.
Check. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3.
That sounds really good.
Check.
And Chris?
Check 1, 2, 3. Check 1, 2, 3.
Yes, everybody sounds beautiful. Oh, right. Dude, it's I know it's a pain in the butt right now, but you guys are going to be so glad when you hear the difference. Okay, well then I guess we're ready to start. I'll count you in, Mr. Main. Ready? 5, 4, 3, 2.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to a very special edition of the Weird Things Podcast. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Brian Brushwood.
Hello, beautiful people. I could not be more excited.
We have Justin Robert Young.
Hi.
Justin, who is this next to you in your studio?
Oh, well, I mean, I didn't know you guys would notice. Ladies and gentlemen, joining us is the author of How Star Wars Conquered the Universe, Mashable Deputy Editor, Chris Taylor. Welcome, Chris.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It's great to be here.
So we have been doing nothing but talking about your book over the last couple of weeks. We all kind of worked its way through the podcast like one by one. Andrew read it, was very over the moon in his praise. Brian read it. I was the last one. Mm-hmm. We all have a million Star Wars questions to ask of you, and just really want to go over again how amazing the book is itself.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate that, and I just want to say I am ready. I am so ready for every nerdy Star Wars question you have. I can tackle it. I can't care.
Can we start actually talking about the genesis of the idea of the book? Because biographies about the Star Wars story, I'd imagine, are a fairly crowded space. And obviously, you knew new movies were coming. How much of it tactically was I suspect if somebody were to tell the story in its best iteration up till now, that book would do really well for the next, 5 to 10 years? Or was this just a space that you were fascinated with and you wanted to dive into?
Well, on one level, I've always been fascinated with Star Wars. I first encountered it on the back of a cereal box in 1978. I've told that story many times. We didn't have a movie theater in my town. I was a little too young for the movies anyway. And, I saw Star Wars on the back of a cereal box first. And then I saw it in the comic books. And then I saw it in the Star Wars figures that my friends would play with, and finally saw Return of the Jedi in the theater. But the genesis of the book itself, you say it's a crowded field. There isn't actually any other book that really covers the whole, all of the bases of exactly what Star Wars is and what the fandom is. And the genesis of the book really got going when Lucasfilm was sold to Disney, October 30th, 2012. And that was the point at which I realized, look, this is a really good moment to have a complete history of the franchise as an independent entity, which it now no longer is. It's slowly becoming more and more Disney as Disney slowly alters the deal. pray they don't alter it any further. But there have been many great attempts, and that there have been many great Lucasfilm books on the making of. And of course, there have been a couple of biographies of George Lucas, which he hated, quite frankly.
Yeah.
There's another one coming, which he is
currently in the process of hating.
Which he is currently in the process of hating. He didn't cooperate with that either. He basically got turned off cooperating with books in 1983. And also nobody had really sort of taken him to task for the way that the story developed and the way that his story of what the story of Star Wars was has developed. The area was very ripe for a fresh look and a fresh investigation. And in many cases, it was the last chance to talk to some of the principals. We have Mr. David Prowse behind the mask here. I got to talk to him. I mean, he's now 80 and admits that he's...
Just talk to him. What we loved about this is it wasn't just analysis. It wasn't just you sitting in abstract. You went out because there have been a lot of conflicting stories about where things came from, whatever. You're following the evolution of Star Wars. And we all love Lucas, but we know that Lucas tends to remember things differently
malleably
each time he tells the story. Sure. And you have a wonderful track record. But like David Prowse, the story of that is amazing. So tell us, there was this rumor, there was a story that Prowse had leaked, that Darth Vader, spoiler alert, that Darth Vader was Luke's father. And some people had said that David Prowse had been telling people this before the movie came out. And you were the first person to actually track this down. And can you tell us your method for doing this?
Yeah, it was, it was a little embarrassing to do that. But the basic story is, so back in 1977, right after Star Wars came out, David Prowse tells a fan at a convention that Darth Vader is Luke's father, and that we're going to find this out in a subsequent film. Then, actually, not too far from where we're sitting, up in Berkeley, he says this again in 1978. This time, it's captured in a local newspaper. Now, because we didn't have the fan culture that we have now, back in 77, 78, the fact that he gave this spoiler didn't really, it just didn't go anywhere. But if you look at it, it's sort of curious because the script had only just been written. You know, it was under lock and key at Lucasfilm. Mm-hmm. The official story, if you look at the making of Empire Strikes Back, you know, and many, and even of Prowse's own autobiography, is that he did not know right up until the premiere that he was fed a false line of dialogue. Instead of "I am your father," he said on set, "Obi-Wan is your father," and then James Earl Jones dubs it in.
Yeah.
But that's, you know, that's a bit weird. If he knew in advance that he was Luke's father, and I, you know, so I had to track him down at the convention because he would not, you know, respond to my request for an interview.
you tracked him down at a convention.
Yeah, so I had to go and stand in that autograph line that where you stand. You know, everyone who's gone to these conventions knows what mm-hmm. that's like. And, you know, I presented him with the article. And then I had to do it again the next day because he'd asked to keep the article and look at it.
Yeah.
So I had to present him with the second copy. Like, remember this? You know, and I got my friend Brian Young to ask him this question on stage. And very quickly he said he had no memory of it. So he's sort of denying it all, but he did very briefly say that you sometimes get in trouble with Lucasfilm for speculating on yeah. stories, which suggests to me that he was just speculating. I would place bets on a slightly less likely scenario, you know, to put in the running here, that Lucas actually mentioned it as a possibility on the set of Star Wars.
Yeah.
Because there's also a story that he went to a convention himself in 1977, and just put it out there that Darth Vader was Luke's father.
Yeah.
Just to see what happened, just as an experiment.
Chris, this is one of the things that really engaged me about the book, is that it's tempting when you're trying to write a definitive history of something to state flatly this happened and this happened or whatever, whereas you seem to have a real comfortability with the idea that we will probably never know exactly what was said or exactly whose idea this was. Was that a conscious decision going into it? Because you do a good job of saying, well, this is what this person says now. This is what they said then. This is what this other person says.
Right, right. Well, I, you know, look, I was trained as a historian first and a journalist second. And as a historian, you're always supposed to say when you don't know something. And I think that's really important. I found in my career as a journalist that that's actually quite energizing to the audience, that the audience appreciates it. If you say, actually, I don't really know this. So then they can just hear the facts, make up their own minds. They're a lot smarter than some people give him credit for.
Now, Lucas specifically seems like somebody that is, you know, Andrew said he remembers things differently, but it almost feels like there are constant revisions, even in his most productive work. Some of the most illuminating stuff that I found in the book was about the original Star Wars screenplay and the process by which that went from A to the fine to what we saw in theaters.
Yes.
Is that something that you found has just been consistent for him, that like the story's always changing and maybe there's always going to be a more perfect version of what has happened and what will be?
I think he does like to revise stories. We know that much. He likes to revise not only the stories that he writes and that he produces, but also he likes to revise the story of how the story happened.
Yes.
And we saw this when the story started to arrive. I'm not sure exactly when, but at some point in the 80s, he started to tell the story that he had the entire Star Wars trilogy entire and that he just chopped it up into thirds, or in some tellings, he chopped it into half, took the second half, chopped that into thirds, and that became episodes 4, 5, and 6. And that is really not true, as he's admitted on other occasions. I think the problem is he is so rarely interviewed and so rarely challenged when he is interviewed that he is able to get away with the story. And, you know, it's a rather neat version of what actually happened, which is, you know, he wrote 3 very different scripts. And you can slowly start to see the Star Wars that we know and love come into focus. But it was changing right up until the end, and it really was not as fatalistic as he put it.
And after.
Yes, and after, of course, the special edition.
But, you know, when you write, you certainly, when we create stuff, we often have these ideas. There's the things that we produce, and there's these things in our head that are so malleable that, like, well, I think I meant this, or I could have meant this, or this could be that. And he certainly, I was as a kid, like, trying to get through to my head, like, you'd hear the stories about, oh, there are nine movies planned. And then, you know, you'd see all these other writers involved in the other movies, and you'd be like, how planned were they?
Yeah, or 12 movies, as he said at one point. I mean, yeah. He has, you know, if you dig, what part of what was interesting about writing this book is if you dig into the ancillary stuff, for example, if you watch Spielberg talking about making the Indiana Jones movies, he at one point just flat out admits that Lucas lied about having all three of those movies prepared in advance. So he has a track record of doing this.
Yeah, and it's the... Yeah, but it's what I mean. I loved your book was because at first I'm like, oh, great, a book on Star Wars. I already know everything there is to know about Star Wars. Boy, was I wrong. Yeah. And it was the level of
detail. He literally would say that. Yeah. Like, that is something that Andrew would like. It's like, oh, I just bought this book. I mean, we'll see what's in there that I don't know. But like, he's extraordinarily knowledgeable on it.
But most of what we know about Star Wars comes to us from Lucasfilm, which has a vested interest. I mean, I love the guys at Lucasfilm, don't get me wrong, but they do have a definite interest in telling the story a particular way.
Oh, yeah. And I mean, I was a kid. I mean, for me, the internet was going to the library and finding Starlog magazine and trying to, you know, find out the latest rumors and stuff. And over years and, you know, eagerly devouring Skywalking and everything else and all those little other kind of bios on Lucas, trying to find, you know, find the stuff. But what you did was amazing. And then, you know, getting into the story of like, you know, Splinter of the Mind's Eye and the novella, the Alan Dean Foster novel that came out after Star Wars. And if you wanted any more proof that Lucas did not have this bastard plan, you know, this book, if you read it now, it is extremely incestuous and just a weird, weird turn for what was supposed to be this planned out universe.
Well, I think
also it could have been the second movie, you know, which totally gives the lie to the fact that he had it all planned out.
Yeah. Well, it's fascinating because one of the, and forgive me if I'm misunderstanding one of the theses of your book, until I read your book, it did not occur to me as a child or even as an adult that Lucas did not intend for Star Wars to be as good as it was. You know, that wasn't his mission. His mission was to do a silly homage to the Flash Gordon flicks and just have a fun, silly thing. And yeah, it'll be cheesy or whatever. And the idea that that instead he hit this grand slam home run, and that once I wrap my mind around that possibility of somebody who's like, I'm just going to do a thing. I'm not going to try to make it good. Oh, wait, a lot of people like it. I guess that's fine. I'm going to tinker with it. Like, that's how you treat a plaything that you don't value very much, which is sort of what Lucas did with Star Wars.
It was odd because on the one hand, he's a total perfectionist. You know, we all know this. He will hammer at something again and again. He'll come back 20 years later and add new scenes, you know, that he felt should have been in the first time around. I mean, he, you know, but that takes place during the production of the movie as well. Absolute perfectionist to his vision. On the other hand, that vision was, you know, way goofier, way more of a silly, as you say, Flash Gordon homage than a lot of us realized. You know, we saw Empire getting dark and the mythology spreading after that, and you know, maybe we read a lot of the books and this universe expanded in our minds, but really, the original intention was just to have something free and fun and a little bit silly, you know, Saturday morning cereal-ish.
Well, and I enjoyed also, you know, seeing the echoes of the Star Wars effect. You know, when you talked about, you know, how Flash Gordon, the Flash Gordon movie, everyone thought they were playing it straight, and then it didn't reveal itself to be so campy until they finally saw the final version. It's fantastic.
So. About Lucas, real quick.
Yeah.
He hates the biographies written about him.
Yep.
He's distrustful of either press or biographers or, you know, the amalgamation that he makes both of them into one idea. When you're writing this and you're talking to people who are either currently employed or formerly employed or have some relationship with Lucasfilm or Lucas himself, is there any rumbling that you get, like, either unofficially or on background from people either around him or him itself to, like, all right, yeah, listen, we're not going to get an official quote on the record, but this is right and this is wrong and we don't want this kind of stuff or we do want this other kind of stuff in there just in terms of point of fact. Like, do you get those kind of rumblings while you're writing?
You know, I was talking to Lucasfilm folks, and I was talking to, you know, obviously Lucas is not employed by Lucasfilm anymore. So he has a whole new set of PR people, and I was talking to those guys for a long time, and but no, nothing. No, he has no interest. He wants to make his movies and he wants to make his museum.
That's it.
He has no interest in how he is represented.
So even on those issues though, like the museum mm-hmm. is a current issue, something mm-hmm. that you detail in terms of you know the Presidio and everything.
Yep.
Even that kind of stuff, you can't get any little tidbit or point of fact.
Not in the slightest. I mean, I did, you know, I went to all of the Presidio meetings one where he actually showed up at the last minute, which was very surprising. So there was that much. I mean, I followed him around to every public event that he was at. But all you get to see there is, you know, and I wrote about this in the book, that notion of the small town banker face,
yeah.
as the editor of Variety put it, that he puts on when he's in public. He's sort of very polite and completely distant.
Mm-hmm. Just wants to get out.
He just, to get there. He will accept your silly award, whatever it is. He happily eventually went back to Modesto to participate in the American Graffiti 40th anniversary, and I wrote about that as well. But you know, I got the sense even there as he's smiling and waving through the streets like he's the Pope. he really would much rather be back in San Anselmo, you know.
I have a friend that was spent some time with him in a dinosaur dig in China, of all places. And even there, where it's just a few group of people, some scientists and stuff like that, they're looking the Gobi for like 2 weeks. He was just the quiet, nerdy guy in the corner that would get engaged in some conversations, but. And then that was it. You know, it was not, you know, it was pretty much what you would see on TV and stuff, very reluctant to talk.
Hmm.
I was very fortunate. I got to know Irvin Kershner a little bit before he passed away. And I never would ask him of any kind of Star Wars stuff, but only on the sort of fringes. But you could kind of see why Empire, and Irvin Kershner, for those of you who don't know, he was the director of Empire Strikes Back, which is the greatest Star Wars film of all time, pops the greatest movie of all time. I'll fight anybody over that one. And Kershner was, you know, much more senior to George, and George went to him because, you know, Kershner had been a film professor, was very, very well regarded, and got away with doing more in that universe than probably anybody else had before or ever would do again until Disney acquired it. And Lucas had said that Empire was his least favorite Star Wars film. I mean, what have you found out about sort of the dynamics of that relationship?
He greatly respected Kirsch. That's why I invited him to do it in the first place. But he was also watching his millions drain away by the second on that movie. And so for him, Empire Strikes Back was this phenomenally traumatic experience because he could not rein Kirshner in. He had way too much respect for him. He felt that Gary Kurtz was supposed to rein, the producer of Star Wars and Empire, was supposed to rein Kirshner in and speed him up a little bit. I mean, Kirshner was as Kurtz put it, you know, very good and very slow in how he filmed that movie, which of course, you know, we look at the result and we say, of course, you know, you needed time to set that up. But, you know, from Lucas's perspective, he was losing money hand over fist. I mean, that movie would never have been financed without a number of things. You know, first of all, the licensing money starting to come in from Star Wars. And secondly, the fact that, they went to, I believe, the First Bank of Boston to refinance it. But Fox had to guarantee it. So they got an extra cut. So, you know, and that was traumatic to Lucas because the one thing he's always wanted to do is keep the studios at bay. And they got a little bit more money out of Empire, which meant less money for Skywalker Ranch. So I don't think that he can divorce what happened in the traumatic shooting of that movie from his awareness of it. Because the one problem Lucas has always had is he's never been able to see Star Wars the way that we have. He's never just been able to go into a theater, and he said this a number of times, never just been able to go into a theater and be really excited about this film.
You know, it's just like Empire, like Star Wars was ended up being like 17 million, then Empire was like 40 million or something, its final budget. And you look at when he did Phantom Menace, you know, 15, 16 years later, the budget had doubled, but a little bit, but it was nowhere it was still a low budget by big budget Hollywood standards kind of thing, which, you know.
Yeah. Lucas was always about doing it on as much of a budget as possible. He always said about, you know, Star Wars that he made a $20 million movie on a $10 million budget. Empire was originally supposed to be $20 million. And, you know, same with Phantom Menace. I mean, he thought that he could make that for $50 million originally, and then it ballooned out of control. But, you know, he had a bit more of a cushion by that point.
That was that was one of the remarkable parts of your book, was seeing, number one, the ability to cast, you know, George Lucas as a young, daring, you know, entrepreneurial outsider as our protagonist, and have us believe and get excited about watching him do his thing was a difficult thing to do, given his reputation among the fans, you know, after in a post prequel era. Was that what was your thinking going into that? To, I mean, not that you necessarily had the job of selling George Lucas back to the kids who had originally bought him, but was there an angle that you had going into it? Or
I really, it may be odd to say this, but I really had no interest in making George Lucas appear like a human being. He is a little bit cold and distant, and, you know, but I think that all geeks can sort of inherently relate to that. He's a bit of an introvert. You know, he just likes to go off and do his research and sit in his writing tower and write scripts very fast on his door desks in his favorite pencil on his favorite pad. You know, but I think that we relate to that inherently. But I really didn't want to tell the story of him so much as I wanted to tell the story of the idea of Star Wars as this independent entity that, as Lucas has said, slammed him up against a wall and threw him across the room, and really took a hold of him in a way that he couldn't let it go. And that's what was ultimately the most fascinating thing for me about this whole story, is he keeps trying to bury Star Wars, right?
Yeah.
He tried to tie everything up and Return of the Jedi and just get rid of it, move on to other projects. The other projects weren't as successful as he hoped. He comes back to episodes 1, 2, and 3 because everyone keeps asking him about it.
Yeah.
It's like, you made episodes 4, 5, and 6. Where's 1, 2, 3? He's like, oh, God, okay. I guess I'll keep making this stuff. You know, and then he gets that out of his system. And then he says, okay, it's over. There's no episode 7, 8, and 9. I never wrote them. And, you know, he all but puts it in his will that there will never be an episode 7, 8, and 9. And then it has to happen because Lucasfilm can't function otherwise.
And I want to get back to that in a second. Mm. We're talking to Chris Taylor. How Star Wars Conquered the Universe is his book. You can get it at howstarwarsconquered.com, or you can go on Amazon and read Andrew's most helpful review, which you can find right there at the top. You have these few points in terms of the Lucas narrative, where he wants to get away, and he wants to do other things, and he doesn't want his life to be defined by Star Wars. But he's built this machine in Lucasfilm and Skywalker Ranch that financially, any responsible people, because he is a responsible person with money, he brings in professionals, doesn't delude himself that this is all going great, and they always come back to the same point. When's the next Star Wars?
Yep.
When can we put out new toys? When can we put out new product that has these characters in it? And if you look at where he's gotten the most crap, it's almost always been from these decisions that seem like, in terms of what we find out in this book, we're meant to keep the lights on and have people continue to have jobs. Now, whether it be for a totally altruistic reason of, I don't want to see all these people pack up their desks, or an ego reason of, I need to keep this empire going. How much of all of this, the prequels, the cartoons, everything that has been the biggest target, has been about Lucas just trying to keep the machine humming?
I think a great deal of it. I mean, he had a very hard time walking away from Lucasfilm. It took him a long time to do it. He would talk for years about just going off and making his own personal films, right? The independent movies. I mean, that's a theme throughout the book.
Except he's not going to show them to anybody. He's just going to put them on iCloud.
He is at the stage of starting to film this stuff, I believe. That's the word, that's the scuttlebutt that I'm getting from the inside, is that he's actually, you know, something is finally written. And it is going to be filmed, and we may or may not hear about it. But you know, this is something that he's been talking about and evidently procrastinating on since 1976, the earliest time that I ever heard anyone talk about.
So this has all been a fever dream since then. In 76, he finishes yes. the script or finishes shooting the movie.
Yeah.
And he's like, all right, I'm about to get into this stuff any second now.
Any second now. Well, he wanted to sell Star Wars to Fox at one point and just be a complete mercenary, step back, make it a James Bond franchise,
yeah.
let everyone else take care of it. He would go off and do his independent movies and run an ice cream shop. That was one of his... for a while. Do low sugar ice cream for diabetics like himself.
Chris,
another visionary move, though. Low sugar ice cream.
But yeah, no, I think that a lot of it was just about keeping that machine going. I mean, obviously, he had to keep Skywalker Ranch going.
Yeah.
He wanted to keep Skywalker Ranch in the divorce, which made it a very, very expensive divorce for him. That's one of the reasons why he had to sell Pixar to Steve Jobs for $5 million plus a guarantee of Steve Jobs throwing in another $5 million to invest in Pixar.
But also his vision of Pixar, though, at the time, I mean, he looked at it as another tool and not a story, you know, thing that was going to really create stories and stuff, too. You know?
He was kind of a visionary on the computer animation front. He knew that computer animation was going to be the future. Mm-hmm. He was, you know, he started off as an animation guy. He was always interested in animation. He hated puppets. He hated the fact that he had to rely on so many puppets. For so many of so much of the original movie. And, you know, he desperately tried to get computer animation into as many of his films as possible. You know, starting off with the scene in on Yavin 4 in the original Star Wars, where we get the schematic of the shot going down into the center of the Death Star and exploding the Death Star. That very high-tech scene, which, amazingly, to his credit, he did not update. That
stayed
computer,
where it was.
It stayed exactly where it was in the special edition.
Because it was perfect.
But, you know, for Return of the Jedi, we get another, you know, and now it's 3D. We get the floating Death Star schematic, basically the same thing. But, you know, and that came out of funding what became Pixar. He had this vision. To his credit, he has these amazing long-term visions down the line of where he wants to be. And he tries to get there.
To be sure, but like a lot of these things didn't flourish until they left, like Photoshop, like Avid, you know, things that were started there. But Lucas had this sort of weird in Pixar. I'm reading in the middle of the Pixar Touch right now, and it's going through the years of when, you know, they're working at, you know, Catmull is at Pixar and working at a Lucasfilm, and how the resistance even within Lucasfilm from people there not wanting to use those tools because they saw themselves as filmmakers. And Lucas, as you look at Star Wars, he had this collaboration with, you know, he's getting some of the best feedback in the world he could help, because he's like Brian De Palma, other people around him who are just amazing, you know, writers, whatever. And then, and giving him advice and casting and stuff. And then, you know, he works with some talented people in Empire and Kirshner, et cetera. And then he decides, you know, besides Spielberg, the last big collaboration until the latest Indiana Jones was what, like Ron Howard and Willow. Mm-hmm. And after that, there was really not him going to appear. He didn't work with a peer until Crystal Skull.
It's an interesting story, because part of what you can see here, and it's kind of tragic, is that slowly over time, he has less and less people saying no.
Mm-hmm.
And by the time of the prequels, you get Rick McCallum, who as producer, who explicitly says that his job is never to say no to George.
Yeah.
Whatever George wants, he's going to make that happen. So there's no Gary Kurtz pushing back. There's no Lawrence Kasdan challenging him. And he tried to get Kasdan involved.
But that was late.
The Phantom Menace, late right. in the day.
Yeah.
Because I think he realized, oh, you know, look, I really need someone to, you know, to give me some shit on this, and not to just be a yes man.
But from Kasdan's point of view,
he was done.
Obviously, he was not against getting involved in a Star Wars project, as we've seen, you know, in this Disney incarnation, but it seems like...
Well, he was against getting involved in a Star Wars project that involved George.
Exactly.
Yes.
Or even, you know... that was that far along that he would have to re-drill on every entrenched position, as opposed to a blank page, what should we do as a Star Wars movie?
I think Lucas said that he knew Kasdan would have pushed back on the one thing that he didn't want to push back on, which was making Anakin 9 years old in episode 1.
Yeah.
Because there was definitely, you know, a range of ages that he could have made Anakin in episode one, according to his original notes.
Yeah.
It could have been 9 or it could have been 20.
Was there a particular moment in your research for the book that was that stands out to you as the most surprising detail that you uncovered about the Star Wars story, or the one that was farthest away from the generally held narrative, or the narrative that you had in your mind?
I think it was really surprising because we hold it in our minds as sort of the one great modern epic that is so singularly identified with a single individual, right? And George Lucas, and certainly in the first movie, we think that. But you know, I knew that wasn't the case, and I knew that, for example, Willard Hike and Gloria Katz had done a rewrite on the last draft of the script and put a lot of the humor in. But just going through the process of take, for example, there's a chapter where I take apart the first 10 minutes of Star Wars, and I look at how much of it is the responsibility of people whose names are not George Lucas. I think that was phenomenally surprising. It's just the extent to which it was a collaborative endeavor. You know, even this thing that was a singular vision,
yeah,
was phenomenally collaborative.
And for somebody who has famously, as Andrew pointed out, not collaborated, it seems like when he does,
oh, yeah,
he's a great collaborator. Like he is good at throwing a lot of stuff at the wall. He's good at identifying what other people's good skill sets are. He has a good track record when he wants to play ball with other people.
Absolutely. And he you know, certainly for the original Star Wars, he was very much a, hey, you know, come on in. Come on, tell me what I should do with this thing. You know, Ralph McQuarrie says that he has an idea for the floating the floating orb droid.
Oh, it's just such a 70s story, too. Yeah. The bunch of people with big hair smoking pot, talking about space. Like.
Yeah. Well, you know, Lucas was not a fan of the fact that ILM were all sitting
pilots
around smoking pot in hot tubs, and certainly clamped down on that. I mean, he was very much a straight-laced guy himself. But yeah, you know, if he recognized you as a specialist in your field, he was like, great, come on in. What ideas do you have for me?
Yeah.
And then he was just going to throw it all and see what sticks.
So it's interesting. You take, like, probably the most successful modern film franchise would probably be, let's say, Harry Potter. And the book's fabulously successful. The movie's extremely successful. Warner Brothers is now coming back, you know, with a new series with Rowling's help. When I walk around, like, I was just at Disneyland Friday, and I saw lots of Star Wars shirts. You know, even, like, you could see, I saw somebody wearing a cap that had Boba Fett colors, but you knew immediately what it was. Avatar, most successful science fiction movie of all time. You'll never see somebody wearing a Avatar t-shirt unless it was, you know, donated to a third world country to, like, keep kids clothed because they didn't sell them at Target or something. What makes Star Wars so special, and just the fact that it's, even compared to those other series or those other, you know, successes, that why is it that way?
I mean, does it boil down to the action figures, do you think? The fact that Star Wars was a part of our childhood in a way no other movie was, because we could reach out and touch those characters, and we became them sitting in
there was Avatar merchandising. The initial launch was huge. Harry Potter merchandising was a huge launch. They all had even bigger plays made at it than Star Wars did, though.
Yeah, well, I think you're close with action figures. I think the essential word here is toyetic, and that was a word that was, you know, used in the toy industry for a long time, and Bernie Loomis of Kenner realized that it applied to Star Wars very much. It was incredibly toyetic. When you look at the characters, when you look at the masks, when you look at the Stormtrooper, you know, you look at Darth Vader, you look at Yoda. I mean, these are just, you know, phenomenally clear archetypes, all of them, and they were all profoundly different. And it's kind of like having the Beatles with, like, you know, 8 or 10 or 20 members, where, you know, everyone had their favorite Beatle, right? And every Beatle was very well defined. Every character in Star Wars, or the original Star Wars at least, is phenomenally well defined. You know, and you can see who they are, you know, with a few seconds of looking at them and that. Or their costume, you know. Yoda is quite obviously the wise guru character, and, you know, Vader is this sort of evil samurai figure with this kind of, you know, dead glare in his eyes. I mean, it's really it's very hard not to see what each character is, right? And if you don't like one, you're going to like another. If you don't like 3PO, you might like R2. If you don't like Han, although, you know, everyone did, you might like Chewbacca, you know. So, you know, there was something there for everyone. There was something for the kids. There was something for the female audience looking for the sexy Han Solo type. You know, there was something there for the questing Luke Skywalkers. I mean, you know, every kind of archetype is in there. It's packed in. It doesn't feel forced. And, you know, those figures stay with you long after, even if you haven't owned a single Star Wars figure.
As you're detailing, you know, the iconic nature of each of these characters, it, of course, makes me think of that moment from the Phantom Menace review from Red Letter Media, which makes me want to ask, like, the way you handled the fan backlash against the prequels, about the mixed bag of, you know, the defenders of the prequels versus the assailers of the prequels. What was it like to dive into that? And did you, I mean, obviously you represent accurately this mosaic of reactions that everyone had, but where do you begin when you start that?
So the chapter is called How I Stopped Worrying and Learned to Love the Prequels, because I like a lot of people of my generation, had that reaction of,
betrayal.
it's betrayal. I don't know. It's just profound, disappointment. I went to the media preview for Phantom Menace in 99. I was working for Time Magazine at the time, and we all filed into this New York theater and we got our blue wristbands. It was, the buildup was so incredible.
Before it came out,
anyone had seen it.
Was it like a week or so, a month?
I want to say.
This is a special thing. This is the most exciting sci-fi movie event in a generation at that point.
Oh yeah, and everyone feels, you feel that jolt go through the audience when the logo comes up on the screen. I went through that, and I initially thought the Attack of the Clones was better, and of course now I feel like it's probably the worst of the original six movies. Revenge of the Sith, I actually, you know, confession time, didn't even watch until I started writing this book.
So let down
by 1 and 2. But
can I tell you, when I read the chapter title, How I Learned to Love the Prequels, I'm like, he didn't learn to love them. It was just a title, you know, for a chapter.
No, I got there. I got there in the end, you know, because the structure of that chapter is the five stages of grief, right? And it seems to track very, very well with very what the fans have been doing. There's the bargaining, where you sort of try and say, well, what if we made it differently? What if we cut out this scene? What if we re-edit all the prequels? You know, there's the anger, which is the Plinkett reviews. There's depression, which is just, you know, we've all been there. Oh, God.
It can never be unmade.
You know, but finally eventually you get to acceptance if you keep going through this. And if you go to like a Star Wars celebration, or if you talk to, you know, Brian Young, is the guy I talked to in that chapter about he has an answer for everything about why the prequels are the way they are. There are people who love the prequels. There are certainly people of a certain generation who love the prequels better than we do. I think especially if you understand that Jar Jar Binks was supposed to be the most annoying character in the galaxy and does actually destroy the Old Republic.
So my problem is, like, I will never argue that those choices weren't intentional. It's just that they're bad. I would say they're bad choices. And it's funny because, like, when you read, let's say, IO9 or Ain't It Cool News, and some movie comes out and people will discuss why it failed, and they'll go like, well, because they didn't use this from this comic book, or they didn't use this costume design or whatever. Rarely 90% of the commentary ever touches on, no, just story. It's story matters, you know, and whether or not this character is supposed to be this or that doesn't matter as much as does it work or does it not work, which is, in a lot of the people who deny that the prequels are awful, you see that. They're just, you know, they can, oh, no, it makes sense. And it's like, well, you know, things can make sense, but it'd be bad.
Yeah. Well, they you know, I think you can still inhabit that universe. You can inhabit the Star Wars galaxy and sort of enjoy, you know, being in the diner with Obi-Wan club where they get the Death Stick Hawker and all that stuff. You know,
by the way, that's brilliant marketing. Let's call them Death Sticks. They'll go over like hotcakes.
Well, that was his whole anti-drug message. That was his you know.
Yeah, it was a little heavy-handed. I mean, you know, obviously there was a lot missing from those movies, and it was partly about the script, but it was also partly about the way it was filmed. It was the fact that, you know, a lot of the times they weren't acting opposite each other. They did not get any direction from Mr. Faster and More Intense. You know, there was, you know, Lucas thought that he could just make actors work in post-production, that they are just sort of action figures and you just kind of stick them there and, you know, come on, Natalie. And
I watched all the behind the scenes stuff on all of the prequels, trying to understand, you know, where did these things go awry? And, you know, one, you see McCollum's enabling him. You know, he's like, no, George, come on, do some more. Yeah, you can do it. And then when Lucas is all excited about, this scene doesn't work, but I can take the lips out from this scene and put them on the actor over here. And
he
was that an actual moment? Was that a thing he did?
Yes. He did. He certainly did that by episode 3. There were a few scenes where he would take the lip movements from one scene and graft them onto the actor from another. I mean, there was such a mixed bag of stuff. I mean, even the guys who defend the prequels will say that they hate, for example, the fact that Obi-Wan is wearing an obvious stick-on beard for a lot of the scenes because they had to get Ewan McGregor back several months later. You know, so there are things that people spot that are just disjointed and wrong, and it just feels bad. But yeah, you know, Lucas. I mean, I think the ultimate acceptance of the prequels is realizing that Lucas just had a different vision for this thing all along. It was just sort of a bit of a silly serial kind of feel to it, and had more of a Flash Gordon stuff. I mean, you know, if you hate the prequels, I recommend going back to watching the original three Flash Gordon serials and four if you count Buck Rogers. That is bad.
Yeah.
Really.
And that can be how you understand the prequels.
So I
want to just really quick go back because we mentioned it before. The way I have come to contextualize the prequels is through the Plinkett reviews, which you do. You know, I was very happy to see you spend time on in the book. What is the sense from inside Lucasfilm about something like that? Because it did seem like this was unlike other fan stuff that relied very heavily on original media through Star Wars. This was about as public and popular a torching as Lucas had gotten in spaces that they seemed to care about. Was there, in your reporting, was there a sense that they were angry about it? Was there ever any idea that they might want to pull, you know, the footage, because it doesn't seem like they ever went through any kind of concerted effort to get it pulled down from YouTube, despite the fact that it was very easy for it to be done.
Yeah, you pull the footage and you start a greater firestorm than, you know, and this is a problem with a lot of how Lucasfilm, you know, treats Star Wars. Well, it's not a problem really, because they just sort of let the fans do their own thing. That's great, because if you start clamping down on stuff like the Plinkett review, then you're censoring free speech.
Yeah.
You know, it becomes very diplomatically, you know, problematic. But yeah, you know, I've heard anger within Lucasfilm at the Plinkett reviews. It's mostly the fact that people will use them as sort of the default for their own thinking.
Yes.
They will just, in the comments section on something, they'll just post a Plinkett video.
There's no protagonist. Yeah. That was probably the biggest thing you pulled out of they made the point of in the first one was that there's no central hero to our story.
I mean, the great thing about the Plinkett reviews is it's kind of taking the piss out of itself,
yes,
in a way, because it's like, you know, here's a guy who
serial killer.
he's this film critic, but at the same time he's a serial killer. Yeah. So how much of what he's saying should you take seriously? You know, how much of it is sort of poking fun at Star Wars fans themselves for being, you know, murderously Plinkett-like?
And you get to that, and Plinkett is in many ways sort of forgiving too to the idea that it is a movie, it is this, and at the end of the day, you know, let's acknowledge everything that went wrong, but he still gave us Star Wars. We're going to want to cut in a second, I think, to the space.
Yeah, as a matter of fact,
launch.
I have it right here, and in fact,
I have a question. Brian.
Go for it.
Remember, Ain't It Cool News back in the 90s was reporting something about, like, there was some sort of problem with the HD capture or something. And I never heard the end of that, of what that was, that they had had some problem that, you know, early on shooting the stuff, and the footage was barely usable, and they had to use all sorts of ILM magic.
No kidding.
I do mention that for Attack of the Clones, I know that there was a problem with the, I believe it was the Blue Channel or the green channel on the HD camera that they use. They got Sony to make it. It was very, very new and was made specifically for the shoot of Attack of the Clones. But basically, they got the footage back at the end of the day and realized that it might as well not have been shot against green screen.
Wow.
It was very janky. There was some weird artifacts all over the place. They basically had to write a bunch of compression algorithms just to get it looking like it should. To get it into sort of, you know, green screen shape before they even throw on the rear projection.
So right now we are 4 minutes out from NASA launching, or from NASA's feed showing the SpaceX launch of which one is this one, Andrew?
Do you want to go to the NASA feed, or is there a SpaceX feed we can use?
You know what? I'll click on whatever the folks in the there's the SpaceX stream right here.
Yeah, go to that.
Yeah, there we go. So one of the things that I thought was interesting, and if you read Andrew Main's fantastic review of How Star Wars Conquered the Universe, he gives a very, very slight asterisk in that he wished that there had been some of the Star Wars talk about how it inspired, you know, Elon Musk over at SpaceX, the fact that he calls the rocket of the Falcon and so on. Had you heard of that before Andrew brought that up?
I hadn't actually. No, that is so. There's a reference to the final chapter in the book. I talk about, you know, Lucas had always hoped that Star Wars would inspire more space exploration. He said that on a number of occasions, that he hopes that the first man on Mars goes there and plants a flag and says, I came here because of Star Wars, or I came here because I was looking for a Wookiee, is what he said in 77. Yeah. But what I found at NASA is that that isn't necessarily the case. People are more inspired by Star Trek. They're kind of annoyed at the lack of the scientific approach in Star Wars, which is, of course, the whole idea. And a lot of people miss that point. It has not been as quite as inspirational as he would like. But I think Andrew had an excellent point about Elon Musk. And I will actually include that in the next version of the book, Andrew.
Hey, so, look at that.
Thank you.
All right. The difference that has been often made is that Star Trek was for socialists. Star Wars was for libertarians.
Yes, yes.
And that the ones that were inspired by Star Wars went off and created, like, John Carmack and Jeff Bezos, a lot of these other ones. Bezos was a super Star Trek fan. Bezos was a super Trek fan. But there are a lot of people who went into it and said, great, I want to be Hans. If you want to be Han Solo, you create SpaceX. If you want to work for the Empire, you go work for NASA.
We just got word. It looks like the chat room is saying that the SpaceX launch has been aborted. Some kind of transmitter difficulty. Launch is currently held. So who knows? Interesting.
We will get back to it if it does launch today or anytime in the next few minutes. So go ahead and stay on the stream.
I think this is the point at which we say, would it help if I got out and pushed?
Yeah. Yes. There you go.
Falcon, after all, right?
Can I tell you real quick, as a kid, that was the one line that I had the biggest problem with, because it seemed to be a direct reference to something that happens on our Earth. Because, you know, the idea is, like, you would get out of a car, you would push, you'd pop the clutch and get it started. And it took some revisionist thinking for me to say, like, well, she just means, like, you know, let me just push it or whatever. Like, it was so close to a planet Earth based reference that it bothered me as a second grader.
Read the Alan Dean Foster version of Star Wars.
Yeah. Oh, really? Is it?
With, you know, it's a space fantasy angle of it, that Lucas definitely wanted these spaceships to look like you could drive them as easily as you were driving a car.
Yeah.
He was a car nut from day one. Of course, we know this from American Graffiti. But that was part of the idea. So I think that was a wonderful reference to that fact, that it is supposed to be like, you know, this, you know, Solo's supposed to be all suave at that moment, and he's taking Leia away with him, and, you know, he's trying to look like a classy guy, and then the car breaks down. I mean, it's such a classic moment. We can all relate to it. But I think it works in universe as well.
Real quick about the new, the sale of Star Wars and the new movies coming out.
Mm.
This, the book is great, the most illuminative that I've ever read an account of, not only where Lucas was before he decided to sell, the fact that he was doing treatments for the new movies, and then approaching Disney, how that whole transaction happened. You said before, they're altering the deal, and Lucas, you know, prays they don't alter it any further. Two things have happened that or have come out publicly that I wonder, from your estimation of Lucas's personality, answer me, which one irks him more? He has said in the press for the Strange Magic review that they are no longer dealing with his treatments for the upcoming movies.
Yes.
There's also been informed speculation that we are going to get a despecialized version of the original trilogy. Which should they both, I mean, one, I guess, is more official than the other, but should they both come to pass, which one irks George Lucas personally more?
If they both came to pass, then absolutely the second one. No question about that. He is so maniacally defensive of his work and his vision for his work that if they somehow magically got the rights to produce an official despecialized edition, which would involve, you know, getting Fox in on the deal, I'm pretty sure it would involve getting Lucas himself to sign off on that too. I mean, it's, you know, you'd have to ask a lawyer about that. But I mean, Fox has the right to distribute Episode 4 in perpetuity.
There's
the thing Disney does not own, will never own, unless Fox sells it to them.
Yeah, without getting into particulars, I've heard from certain parties that like that deal was made, you know, for that. And I, you know, and I won't say what production companies or whatever they work for, but just say there'd be material involved, but that was that they were like, oh no. Yeah, no, we did that. So don't know if that's true, but cause I was the thing too, is like, yeah, Fox having the rights on that. But then again, Fox wants money, you know, and because, you know, that I've heard that that is more likely to happen. And I think the argument to George is that happens, he's upset. It's like, listen, you said it didn't exist. You said that you destroyed the original. So, you know. Well,
we know that the original exists. There's a 4K version in the Library of Congress.
Yeah.
You can make an appointment to go and watch it at any point and watch it legally. You don't need to download the illegal despecialized edition.
Sure.
Which, of course, none of us have ever done.
No. Sweet Lord, no.
No, we wouldn't recommend. We wouldn't recommend looking for the downloadable despecialized edition.
God, sweet Lord.
No.
We wouldn't even dream of praising the efforts of those who made possible the despecialized edition.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, we wouldn't praise them as conquering heroes.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, that'd be crazy.
I mean, there are about 20 of them online, so it would be not hard to find different despecialized editions. So.
What happened? I'm sure now you're much more plugged in now. What's going on? So, aren't leaving Force Awakens, the change up in writing there? Mm-hmm. What have you heard? What do you know?
As much as anyone else at this stage. I mean, it's that stuff is locked up tighter than Fort Knox at the moment. I mean, you know. But yes, I mean, it does seem like there was. We know that the Lucas treatment was thrown out. He's confirmed that. And we know that it wasn't really probably that good in the first place, based on Bob Iger's reaction to it, the CEO of Disney. He said, from a storytelling perspective, we thought they had a lot of potential. Which, you know, does Bob Iger speak for?
Yeah.
Take this crap away.
Sure.
My understanding is...
Do you have a sense of what they centered around? Had you heard any kind of broad story schedule?
You know, the story has always been that it was way more focused on the new generation, and that what Abrams and Kasdan came in to do when they took over the writing from Michael Arndt, who was working on basically the Lucas treatment, was that he's made it much more an homage to the original trio.
Gotcha.
That they factor in much more, and we can sort of
those two things are kind of inextricably connected. Then that Arndt was working on the Lucas treatments.
Mm-hmm.
They get into the hands of the new regime,
yeah.
And now we are no longer dealing with those stories, nor are we dealing with Michael Arndt.
Yeah, my understanding was that they wanted to give Arndt, you know, the benefit of letting him take a shot at the first draft, seeing what he came up with. And then they said, thank you very much, goodbye, we'll take it from here.
Let's just hope we see a third Death Star in the new trilogy.
I think they've learned their lessons on that. I mean, I think, you know, a lot of people are antsy about J.J. Abrams, and they see his work on Star Trek, and I'm one of those people who was not a fan of Into Darkness at all. But he was always much more reverential about Star Wars than he was about Trek. And I think that he...
To the point of borderline disrespect with Trek.
Yes,
at a certain point,
yes.
You know, where he's just like kind of openly, even on the first one, which everybody generally had good feelings for, it was kind of like, hey, I'd kind of rather be directing Star Wars, but like that ain't going to happen, am I right?
Yeah, so let's just turn Trek into Wars, basically. Yeah. Let's make it more about the interpersonal conflict of the crew, which, you know, would have Gene Roddenberry spinning in his grave. Because for him, there were never any conflicts between the crew, right? Nobody could ever be at war within the confines of the Enterprise. But yeah, so he's much more reverential about this stuff. I mean, everything that we're hearing, we can get into spoiler territory, but everything that we're hearing leaked from, you know, what is supposedly The Force Awakens, suggests, I think, I'm intrigued. I like the sound of what they're doing here.
I'm super stoked. It's like, I enjoyed both Trek and Into Darkness thoroughly, and I will gleefully point out all the plot holes and all the silly things, and the whole line to us about Khan was silly and whatever, because I liked them, even though I thought the scripts were so flawed, he made them so much fun, and that's what has me excited about Star Wars, is the idea that I'm pretty sure what they're going to shoot is going to be in far better shape than what was shot for those, and given what he did with those, you know, I'm fully on board.
He gets the sense of humor that is essential for Star Wars. And that's something else that really came out during the writing of the book that surprised me, is how close Star Wars is to comedy.
Well, and that was a surprise. It's one of those things that it's a truth that's sat under my nose for 30 years. And then it wasn't until you wrote those words that I was like, oh my God, yeah, there are some really silly, funny parts in Star Wars. And I would never have thought of it as a comedy.
Yeah, and part of what doesn't work about the prequels is that the comedy falls flat. But the jokes are in there, the attempts at jokes.
Ah, man, that Gungan definitely stepped in poop. That was the thing that happened.
If you're under 8 years old, that stuff is...
Although it's interesting with children who start with the prequels, then watch, you know, the original trilogy, and see... I meet more and more kids under the age of 10 that love Star Wars or Empire or Jedi better than the prequels. That once they see those, they, for some reason, you know, it's not this generational divide that we were told that it would be, that, you know, it has been. I've seen, you know, some kids sometimes they pick up on something that makes sense.
What do you think of Rebels? Seems to have their own preferences. And I mean, you know, Lucas has said on stage at Celebration that it's this very specific defining line, right? If you're under 30, you love the prequels and you hate the original trilogy, and vice versa if you're over 30. But, you know, I think that's just sort of his kind of a hangover from the 60s. He actually said this on stage with Robert Redford recently, that he's you know, he still doesn't feel like trusting anyone over 30, so
yeah,
it's always part of his mindset. But no, it's not true. You know, you talk to kids, and some of them love Phantom Menace, some of them hate it, some of them think Revenge of the Sith is the best thing ever, some of them think Return of the Jedi is the best thing ever. We all have very specific preferences. We can't always explain them, but it doesn't fall into this sort of neat category of age.
No.
Or you know.
I was talking to a friend's daughter. She's 8 years old, and Star Wars came up. I'm like, oh, you like Star Wars. What do you like? What's your favorite Star Wars movie? And she goes, well, my favorite part was when Anakin said, and as soon as she said Anakin, I start to shake. You know, I'm like, oh, this kid. Then she goes, when Anakin said, Luke, I'm your father.
Oh, that's
my
great.
Favorite movie too. And I'm like, oh, there's hope. And that was just, that, you know, but the thing was different. It's for her. It's Anakin.
Yes.
And not Darth Vader, but still her favorite movie was Empire.
It is interesting. I mean, this is the way in which the prequels can work, I think. And I cover machete order in the book.
Yeah.
The notion of watching it in the order of 4, 5, 2, 3, 6, right? So you get this extended flashback after the I Am Your Father scene. And it is very interesting. If you shift the order in which you watch them around, you get a different emotional response. And, you know, kids will say this about Yoda when they see him crop up in episode 5 after having watched him in the prequels. They're like, he's gone a bit nuts. What's the matter with Yoda? He keeps hitting R2 with a stick. What's his problem? You know, he's gone crazy in the swamp.
By the way, one of my favorite moments after reading your book was having the pleasure to be the one to let Michael Barrett know that that you name check his belated media presentation of what if the prequels were good. I don't think he had heard and ran out and to grab the book immediately afterwards.
Yes. He you know, I love his enthusiasm. I think that's. It's sort of the opposite of Plinkett, right? When he does the...
in this yin-yang kind of way. I mean, it's just as scathing and it's just as honest in that it recognizes all the flaws with the Phantom Menace, but this optimism, and it's astonishing to hear how few tweaks really could have made it a very, you know, enjoyable movie.
Absolutely. I think he did that very well as well, but he also has been surprised at the reaction. You know, he never intended to do an episode 2, and he's still, I think, having trouble with the episode 3, what if that were good, video.
Right. Well, it's tough, too, because you start to get farther in.
Story on top of story on top of story.
He's caught now. I mean, he's caught in the same sort of trap that I think a lot of people who are involved in any part of the Star Wars movies is as well. It does suck you in, and, you know.
But just the fan demand for it.
Yeah.
Going forward... How much do you think George Lucas is going to be a part of this new Star Wars universe as any kind of public figurehead?
Well, he's to his credit, staying as far away as possible from discussions of what it's going to be. He said he hasn't seen the trailer.
I guess he said recently he had eventually. I guess during the Strange Magic.
He did finally say he's seen it.
He got around to watching that, you know, 32 second.
And he probably said, Yeah, I mean, he's,
you're ruining my movie.
But you know, he wants to finally have that experience of going in on opening day and seeing it.
Why is Lando in the desert?
You know, yes. If I was him, I would step away as much as possible. I mean, we know that he has a cell phone now, which is
a change
given Dave Filoni nightmares. He has been talking constantly to J.J. Abrams.
Oh, really?
You know, Jet Lucas has said this, that they talk on the phone, quote, every day. You know, but I imagine it's much more of the relationship that he would have had with Kirshner had money not been an issue.
Yeah.
That he's much more in the background and he's just answering any questions that are posed to him. You know, just general questions about how does this universe work?
Yeah.
How do the physics of Star Wars work? Answer Abrams, is, you know, not very much. But still, you know, you got to get it precisely right.
Well, and again, you're back into where he has had his greatest success, which is to be a part of a collaborative team.
To be the guy who's a writer and a strong person that can, you know, well, that's great, George. You know, we have one question we want to pull in here for a second. But also, have you watched Star Wars Rebels?
Yes, I have. I'm not fully up to date with it, but I really like what they're doing there. I think it could be a little more complex storytelling wise. It sounds like it's going in that direction, but they're bringing the kids along for the ride, which is great. It's very promising. I think much more so than Clone Wars was.
Yeah.
By the way, real quick, Elon Musk just tweeted that the Air Force tracking radar went down and that the launch will be the same time tomorrow. So it's not even Han Solo's fault.
So. Brian.
Yes, sir.
What could you tell about getting a call from the set of a certain movie?
Oh, geez. One of the most surreal things to happen during 2014, Chris, was I got a phone call from, I got an email from a friend of mine, Greg Grunberg. He was in Heroes, and he's a childhood friend of J.J. Abrams. And he says, he's like, hey, how did David Blaine make the card appear inside the fruit? JJ wants to know. And I'm like, wait, what? And then my phone rings and it's Greg and he's in England.
Just give him backstory on what that meant.
Well, dude, I can only conjecture what that might mean.
No. What does the fruit thing, the Blaine and the fruit thing?
Well, and this is what I'm finding out because I don't get a context at first. Oh. And it turns out that Harrison Ford has been hammering J.J. Abrams, who's a magician, trying to find out how David Blaine made his selected card appear in the fruit. And then Greg calls. And I was like, oh, well, you know, it's usually, you know, when, maybe it's going to be this kind of thing or that kind of thing. And he's like, just talk to JJ. And he hands the phone over and I realize I'm talking to JJ Abrams. And JJ Abrams is like, you got to watch the video. Go look at it and then get back to me. I was like, well, I know the people who worked on the special, so I can find out, whatever. So I go and I look at it and it's clear to me as a magician that something had to happen before the cameras start rolling. And so I call back and I say to JJ, I was like, look, something had to happen before the cameras start rolling. That's the only way you could do this. And he's like, yeah, but Harrison swears that he just thought of a card and it happened to be the exact card transported from the deck into the fruit. I was like, well, all right, well, I'll find out. I'm trying to figure out how to wind this up in a way that I can say
the non-spoiler sort of way.
Can't really throw in the punchline. I'll tell you the punchline
after. Okay. All right.
But
this was the day after the rumor of Harrison Ford injuring himself on the set was going on. And so later, 2 days later, there was talk about how, you know, one of the rumors was that there was so much Han Solo in Episode 7 that they were going to have to change X, Y, or Z in order to make it work. And I remember Justin saying, like, well, that can't be because we have it on authority that the director of Star Wars was busy calling to find out how a card trick worked the next day and not panicking, freaking out, turning everything upside down.
But also just the idea, and we just laughed for days about this, like this visual of Harrison Ford dressed as Han Solo for the first time in decades at much public consternation is just like blaster, like hanging off. It's just like, you know, cut, like, no, but JJ, he didn't do anything. I was watching him the whole time, and then a garage door comes down on his leg and breaks it, and you know, delay the shooting of the movie.
I really hope he said he hoped it sounds like a lot of simple tricks and nonsense.
Yes.
I'm not supposed to believe in magic. Come on, Harrison.
On the subject of Harrison Ford, it seems to me that there was a qualitative difference in his acting before Empire and after Empire. And you talked a lot in it about how much he had a lot of conversation with Kirshner. And it seems like the guy that did, you know, Frisco Kid, you know, and some of the other stuff, and then the guy that shows up as Indiana Jones and then Deckard and Blade Runner felt like 10 years of just, you know, acting. But it was just a 2 or 3 year difference. The only thing I could think was Kirshner.
Kirshner was definitely a big prop to him on Empire. Obviously helped him come up with some of his key ad libs, which, you know, I'm not sure how many people realize just how many of Han Solo's lines were ad libbed in that movie, like "you old smoothie" or, of course, famously, "I know."
Yeah.
And Kirshner, you know, definitely built him up to that. But I think he was already there. I mean, he was older than the rest of the cast. That made a huge difference. And that sort of languid stoniness that he has as Han Solo, which of course we know, you know, this is no secret that he was smoking some very strong weed on the set of Star Wars and continues to do so from all accounts to this day. You know, he figured out that works. I mean, when you see yourself on the screen 30 times, as you know, I mean, I'm sure even Harrison Ford saw Star Wars 30 times. Mm-hmm. You know, you start to get a sense of what works in that role. What is it about that character? And that can grow on you and you know, grow you as an actor and give you a sense of who you are and maybe interfere with your identity a little bit. But you know,
or interfering with your fruit at home.
Never mind. We'll still save the punchline.
Here we go. Anybody who's going to pick it up is going to pick it up.
So I guess this is normally the part of the show where we give some picks for some stuff that we're reading. You want to go into that, Andrew?
Sure. My pick is How Star Wars Conquered the Universe by Chris Taylor. If you haven't, buy it from first choice. Go to Amazon or bookstore. Pick up the hardback copy. Pick it up there. That does the most for Chris. It is an awesome book. It's something you're going to have on your coffee table. And as this Star Wars thing blows up again and even bigger and bigger and bitter, bitter if it doesn't work out, you're going to want to know. It is a book about culture. It's a book about business. It's a book about a personality. If you're a creative and you want to understand where do great things come from, and often, you know, success has many, many parents, and there is this idea that people want to think that, you know, Star Wars, there was just George Lucas sitting there like George R.R. Martin just creating this thing out of ether, and that's not the way it worked. That's not how it happened. And not to take anything away from George Lucas, who gave me the greatest gift that I could ever hope for in my childhood, and I think our other child, you know, other people too, it was at its best, it was this collaboration with really, really talented people, and that was my biggest takeaway from that, and just how easily it could have sucked.
Mm. Which you is know. To take nothing away from the tenacity of George Lucas. I mean,
and there are other people who have had opportunities come their way that they never were able to make use of. And George is persistent. And George, I think he's been very, very consistent. I think the guy that was back doing crazy little art films in college, like Look at Life and other things, there is a reason. And you go watch, you know, go. I recommend Chris Taylor's. I recommend you know, the Jim Henson biography too. And you see a lot of parallels between these two guys who have a very good grasp for creative and a very good grasp for business and built amazing empires onto that. But
and did you know that the author of the Jim Henson biography is the guy doing the Lucas biography?
No. Yeah. Interesting.
It's his next project.
He's currently hating.
I don't tell him not to do another chapter on the invention of television. That was the thing, but the Henson thing I was put down because like when Baird was looking at the field, and then, you know, like starts ends like George, Jim Henson, you know, he wanted a TV, and they start giving us the history where TV came from. I'm like,
oh, geez.
Yours was action packed. Oh, my God. When yours was over, I was sad. When's your next book coming out? Come on.
Actually, can you spill that? What are you working on next?
Well, it's, you know, probably not. Well, it might be a little bit Star Wars related, but I'm very curious, and it sort of spun out of this book on how other worlds and sort of fictional realms have this control over us, have this tyranny. You know, once they're sketched out and mapped out to a certain degree, you know, who hasn't inhabited Westeros in their minds or yeah. Middle Earth? And I'm really curious about how this affects us. I'm especially curious about utopia and dystopia, mm-hmm. and how dystopian worlds have been on the rise in the past few decades, probably ever since Blade Runner, speaking of Harrison Ford. And, you know, that sort of seemed to spin things off in a different direction. But it also seemed to affect us personally and affect us politically in terms of, you know, well, that's sort of the only vision that we had of our futures.
Yeah,
going forward. So maybe that affected us.
Do you think the rise of dystopian storytelling in the modern age is maybe an implicit acknowledgement that things are getting so much better in our real lives? Like, you know, you always want what you don't have. And 100 years ago, what you didn't have was plentiful food and disease-free lifestyle. And then now, as we, you know, just live in what by all metrics are better society, it has us, you know, longing for the fantasy of, you know, a Fallout world or something like that.
Yeah, people don't really talk much about the death wish in human psychology, but it's definitely there, and I think it's there as a society that we're always expecting the next disaster. It's like, well, things are going too well.
Yeah,
you know, progress. We're due a big war. You know,
we're due to start sending our kids in to murder each other for our own pride or something. I don't know.
I know. It does feel like we sort of bring that about subconsciously because we expect it to happen. You know, and we keep telling ourselves stories about zombie-filled world or, you know, a Hunger Games world.
Yeah.
Just because, you know, that's the only future that we see because utopias get laughed at these days. So, you know, I want to produce a book that will prevent utopians from getting laughed at.
Hey, Chris.
Have you talked to or been involved much with like the USC World Building Project? Like they just did the last science of fiction thing, the whole big workshop on world building.
I actually went to USC and talked to some folks about that. So, you know, I would love to participate in that class. That may be a chapter in the new book, but
maybe.
We'll see.
random USC side jag for anyone listening right now. If you want to see something fascinating to me, is look up both George Lucas's and James Cameron's USC film projects, and it is astonishing to see how much better George Lucas's THX short has aged than James Cameron's. I forget what it was, but it's all stop motion and cheesy, very 1980s retro future fonts and stuff.
Cameron didn't go to USC though.
Was it not USC? I guess whatever his film school project was, whatever school he went
to. Oh yeah, I'm sure. Yeah.
Wanna
too.
Xenogenesis. There it is, right here.
I've never seen it.
Oh, have you not? I'll throw a little bit of it here.
That's his job with Roger Corman, right? Which is,
Yeah, here, I'll just kind of click through it, but it's very, you know, matte painting, force perspective stuff. Whereas amazingly, THX is still haunting and moody, and it doesn't rely on. Go ahead.
Yeah, but I remember the original THX, the original one that Lucas did. I mean, he had, you know, kind of basically the resources of the Navy to help him build that.
Yeah, it's all Navy guys in it. It's all just, you know, locations that they could access. He basically stuck a cardboard box on one Navy guy's head and said, pull levers. and that's sort of the early Stormtrooper.
Xenogenesis looks way better than I would have thought it would have. I mean, that's actually considered.
Well, again, you could tell it was groundbreaking for 1978, but it looks very 1978, whereas THX, I think, does appear a lot more timeless. You know, it seems intentionally arty at any rate.
Yeah. Mm.
Yeah. Hey, man, my pick is How Star Wars Conquered the Universe by Chris Taylor. It's a great book.
Tell us more about it, Brian. Complete the circle. How Star Wars Conquered the Universe. Go ahead and get it. HowStarWarsConquered.com. Chris, mm-hmm. however, I mean, you're the guest. You do get to make a pick. Since we've all plugged your book and you have no reason to plug it a fourth time, are there any other like Star Wars books that you know, either helped you along or you found was maybe outside of what some of the popular biographies or retellings are?
We definitely should give a shout out to Michael Kaminsky and The Secret History of Star Wars. I mean, it's very thorough. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of, he goes to all of the, everything that was out at the time when he wrote it. He wrote it, unfortunately, before all the Lucasfilm making of books came out with a whole bunch of new details. But he kind of blazed a trail there. It was a very good effort, and I recommend it as a companion book.
Now, am I remembering right? Like, this book was written and then had to be scrubbed and got released for free or something?
It was released as an ebook first, and I think then there was a sort of a limited publication release. I've talked to Michael. He's a lovely guy, and he's still, I believe, the only writer of anything Star Wars who's had any communication with Marsha Lucas over the years. He got a few emails from her, and he's sort of the definitive guy on what happened to Marsha after the divorce. So that's definitely worth looking
at. Which, by the way, I mean, she was far more involved in the original trilogy up right up until the divorce.
Yes.
Than I think anybody. I mean, certainly the Lucasfilm would ever.
Yeah.
Give any kind of credit.
Yeah, she's definitely been minimized for obvious reasons. George took it very hard when they divorced. But she's you cannot ignore her contribution. She's the only Lucas who ever got an Oscar.
Yeah.
Apart from the Lifetime Achievement Award that George got. But she got it for editing Star Wars, and she certainly deserved it. You know, she and her fellow editors did so much with so little material, she cut together the Death Star sequence, which was a phenomenal piece of editing.
Absolutely.
And of course, you know, Return of the Jedi, she did, you know, what George dismissed as the dying and crying scenes, including the death of Yoda, and you know, came up with all sorts of stuff that he wouldn't have thought of. Made sure that the kiss for Luke before the Death Star canyon. The chasm jump was still there. Made sure that the mouse droid, you know, running away from Chewbacca.
Yeah,
there's the guy. And by the way, that scene is exactly why Simon Pegg and Nick Frost are friends, is because they could imitate those noises that started their friendship.
Oh, that's amazing. That's
as soon as the Force Awakens trailer came out, Brian and I were doing Imperial Probe Droid. Like, dude, you hear the...
Yeah, the BB-8 noises are being...
I'm writing BB-8 fan fiction right now.
Chris, is this your... are there other books of yours that we should be checking out?
This is the first one. I mean, I write a lot at Mashable. And I wrote at, you know, Time Magazine before that, Business 2.0. I had a column at CNN called Future Boy, which is where the Twitter handle comes from. But yeah, this is the first time I've sat down and created a full-length book. And,
well,
you know,
done.
It's an alternately horrifying and addictive process.
I just realized I won't have another opportunity to share this with you, but I believe you talk about Ernie Cline's movie Fanboys, right, in the yes. book?
Yes, yes.
Ernie Cline, I stood in line with him we went and saw the Phantom Menace together, and I remember him sending an email like a week later. He's like, "Well, I watched it again, and I'm just gonna say it. It's a terrible movie. Brief islands of awesome surrounded by a sea of suck." Is the way he put it, and I don't know. It was cool to read about, you know, him in the context of your full story.
So, you know, I wish they would make Fanboys 2, because I got Kyle to talk about what that would have been, and how it would involve the three main characters after Attack of the Clones. You know, one guy trying to rationalize it, one guy hating it, one guy going, "Oh, I don't know, guys, stop fighting."
That's amazing.
We need that.
Epilogue here. So out of nowhere, strange magic appears. You know, it's like 6 months ago, you know, Disney registers this, and then I get, like, you know, I get El Capitan, you know, alerts and stuff. I'm like, come see the strange magic. It'll be here for, you know, 45 minutes, and then we're gonna get it out of our theater as quickly as possible. What else is waiting? What else has he made? I mean, he made an entire feature film animated movie nobody knew about and licensed all these pop songs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, there were rumors and rumblings of this for a long time, and you know, it's easy to hide an animated film that nobody really necessarily cares about, the extent that they care about Star Wars. I don't think that there's anything else on his docket that I know of. I could be wrong, but I think the next thing may well be the long-awaited personal movies.
Yes.
Which, you know, I hope one day we get to see.
Yeah, I mean, because he's very, I mean, obviously, you probably know far better than any of us how weird of a guy George Lucas is, but, like, is he just going to always be weird about managing expectations for everything that he does because he has had this, and to his credit, a hyper-realistic experience over the past several decades. The majority of his adult life has been in this weird bubble where all anybody cares about is this one thing you did at one moment.
Yeah, I think he's made his peace with the fact, and he said this on a few occasions, that the first line of his obituary will read George Lucas, creator of Star Wars.
Yeah.
You know, and he knows
that. By the way, a great first line of an obituary.
I know, right?
That's an amazing first line. I would kill for that first line.
What's funny is I hadn't really thought about what it must be like to be in that position until I read your book. But it occurred to me, like, oh crap! If I were to die of a stroke today, it would be like there's one thing that you'll be remembered for. And I realized if I died, it would say Brian Brushwood, a host of the internet program Scam School. And it's like I don't think any of us want to believe that we're just that one thing. But so I understand the need to, you know, leave or try to leave Star Wars behind.
He has said, you know, he talked to the author of Skywalking, Dale Pollack, about this, about the notion that he feels that when he dies and faces his maker, you know, he will be slapped down for not having done enough.
Really?
Which is ridiculous to most of us, but yeah. he still is in this mindset of, he had that crash when he was in his teens, and it changed everything. And, you know, every day became, you know, a chance to do something new. And I feel that he has not, for all he has done, he's not done enough with the intervening years.
One more question, then we'll wrap it up. So when we talk about the prequels, specifically The Phantom Menace, it's 1999. It's the same year that Titanic comes out, right? Mm. Or, like, so it's Star Wars is briefly the number one movie.
So yeah, so after 97, after the special edition was released and episode 4 was all counted as one
as
release,
one, yeah.
Then it was it briefly took over from E.T.
Yeah.
And then Titanic.
Titanic comes. That period of history where Spielberg and Lucas and Cameron are all kind of in the height of their power, although not necessarily creatively at their peak. Mm-hmm. How much of an ego battle is it between those three people who have tasted rare air in terms of movie box office grosses on who is the number one movie, who has made the most, and all that kind of stuff? And how much does it affect Lucas's actions for everything else that goes into it?
Well, certainly Lucas and Spielberg had a friendly rivalry.
Yeah.
I don't think that's any secret. I think it may be a little less friendly with Cameron. But also Lucas said many times going into The Phantom Menace, you know, there was no way to compete with Titanic. You know, he knew that that was a once in a lifetime kind of thing, like the original Star Wars.
Except
I mean,
for the fact that everybody was burying Titanic and calling it like
a
star before it was released.
Once, I mean, it actually came out during the filming of Star Wars, of Phantom Menace in 97. And, you know, there's film of him on the set going, yeah, there's no way. There's no way we can compete with that. And everyone's like, come on, George, it's Star Wars. And he's like, nah, you know, I made more American Graffiti and it made 10 cents. You know, you can destroy these things. So he was the one guy in the world who was denigrating the chances of The Phantom Menace and saying that it wasn't going to be the biggest thing since sliced bread was George Lucas.
And they said the same thing about Avatar, too, though. And I think that had, you know, it's like had Star Wars, had episode, you know, one been really good. And now we get to play that again. You know, we'll see Force Awakens.
If The Force Awakens is good, it is my opinion, and you can tell me whether or not you think it's ridiculous or not, that if Force Awakens is good, now not necessarily great, not necessarily genre or generational defining, if it is good, it could be the highest grossing movie of all time.
There are a couple caveats there. Cameron with Avatar and Titanic timed those things when ticket prices went up, and then Avatar is built for an average ticket price increase and 3D. So there's the little economics bugaboo that went into there that helped it do really well. Even still, it still did like $500 million more than Titanic did, and Titanic did like $600 million more than Avengers. But there is that factor, Justin. I'm just saying that.
Sure. You know. So wait, but would that go for or against that point?
I'm saying is that I would say that unless there's some sort of timing with ticket prices that Cameron was able to exploit, you know, that he did for Avatar, it may not, you know, because of like where ticket prices, you have audiences have been falling. And then if you get that ticket price bump, then you sort of, you catch back up. And so Avatar, actual butts in seats versus actual dollars spent, you know, are two different things.
Yeah, so, I don't know. I mean, personally, I don't think there's any doubt. You know, we've got many bets going on right now about whether Avengers 2 or Force Awakens is going to be the bigger hit or the bigger opening weekend. I think anyone who's even betting on that is nuts. Of course it's going to be The Force Awakens. I mean, everyone is going to have to see it. It's going to be The Phantom Menace all over again. The Phantom Menace, just in sheer dollar amount, was the largest grossing Star Wars movie of all time. And it's because, you know, even though the bad reviews had filtered through by that point, everyone had to see it. Everyone had to make their own minds up about it. And this will be absolutely the same. Everyone will give it the benefit of the doubt. We'll all go see it, right? We'll
be opening night.
we'll see. If I got nothing else going on.
And maybe we'll see it three times because we have to really
I couldn't
make
bring
our
myself
minds up
to go to the 3D re-release of The Phantom Menace, just because I have some shred of dignity still left. But if they were to 3D re-release the original trilogy with all the special editions, I would have went.
Okay. You know, that was the plan. And then you look at the box office from Phantom Menace re-release in 3D and then to Attack of the Clones and just the huge drop. They realized that he was going to lose money on a third. And then,
yeah. Yeah. And thankfully, we should be thankful for small mercies that The Force Awakens will not be in 3D. It will be in IMAX, however.
Just so delightful.
Yeah, so we'll have to go see that version. And then if you can't get into the IMAX screening, you have to see the normal screening. You have to see it twice anyway just to make sure.
I mean, you're going to need to do it. I mean,
I mean, how many times has the trailer been viewed now? I think they released it's like 200 million views on that thing.
Seeing the brilliant specialized edition of the trailer surface, within 24 hours of the trailer dropping was utterly extraordinary. That was the internet at its best.
So we know definitively that it's not going to, they're not going to do a 3D version of Force Awakens.
Yeah. They've from what limited things we know from the set generally is what has been Instagrammed and tweeted out of there. And all we've seen is an Instagram of an IMAX camera.
Oh, I know. It's not being shot in 3D. I know that. But I'm saying that they do most, like a lot of the Marvel films weren't shot 3D. They just have this horrible post-conversion process.
My sense is they're avoiding it largely because of the reaction to Phantom Menace in 3D and the fact that they had to hold back the other two prequels in 3D. You really don't want to bring back memories of that.
I hate 3D personally. Absolutely hate.
Really? Even Avatar's use of it?
I mean, I have seen Avatar far more times on my TV here, not in 3D, and enjoyed it. It was a fun first time to go do it, but it didn't add a single bit to the storytelling. It was an amusement park ride. It was a gimmick. It was a fun gimmick, but it was
a rad ass amusement park ride,
and,
man.
And that was the last time I enjoyed it. You know, like I remember, it died for me when I saw Toy Story 3D. Toy Story 3, because I said this was created. It's everything is perfect right to do this. I said I don't care. It's distracting. It's not, and I'm not alone in that.
Huh? I'm not saying you should be alone. That's fine.
No, I'm saying tickets like real 3D. Those companies are suffering because. It's been people, if they have the choice, they vote against it because it's.
I'm not a 3D hater. I actually, there are certain movies that I'm glad to see in 3D. Seeing How to Train Your Dragon 2 in 3D, I thought was a really good experience. But hey, man, we're not supposed to talk about 3D. We're supposed to wrap up Weird Things and thank Chris Taylor for joining us.
Well, thank you guys. It's been a whole lot of fun.
It was utterly precious for us one by one to experience your book and giddily call the others. The only person not in on our club or that's not here is Tom Merritt, just finished it. And the ability to revisit so many amazing memories and to get the fairest, the most authoritative version of the story to date has been utterly extraordinary. Thank you for this gift.
Well, thank you very much, guys. That's very, very nice of you to say. And thank you, Andrew, for the wonderful review on Amazon. And if you guys have any more questions or any viewers have any more questions, I'm always happy to answer. Just tweet me at FutureBoy.
And again, that is how Star Wars conquered the universe, howstarwarsconquered.com. Thank you very much, Chris.
Thank you. Thanks, guys.
Go buy his book.
Right on. Dude, Chris, that was fantastic.
Thank you. I hope that sounded okay.
Oh, it was great. It was super great.
Flipping my arms around too much. I have a tendency to do that.
It's Chris, like they did, like they released the trailer in 3D for Force Awakens.
Did they? Well, I mean, maybe
the El Capitan Theater, they did it. They showed it. They had a 3D version of the trailer.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Interesting. Yeah, I haven't seen a whole lot of discussion on that. I mean, my sense is that they're really trying to avoid any...
I want you to be right. I want you to be right.
at all. Anything that could be vaguely controversial about this. They want this to be as smooth as possible. They want it to speak for itself. They don't want fans to fight about anything about this film. So,
well, and even it felt like the decision to go to film was just as much a political one as an artistic one. It was as though he was, you know, giving a wink to the fans, like, don't worry, we're taking it back to what you wanted, guys.
There's a lot of dog whistles in what JJ has been doing. The puppet that he had in that.
The video
that comes along. Because this is not just a movie, and it's not just a trilogy. It's a universe that, you know, they already have films in the works on, like, and you know, who is it? I think it was James Gunn who wrote a Facebook post about, you know, the difference between the Marvel universe and the DC universe, or universes in general, now that everybody's the suits are universe crazy, is that, you know, Hunger Games had a movie that everybody liked, and that obviously it was a book series, but they expanded it beyond that. But everybody liked that first movie. Everybody liked the first Harry Potter one. Everybody liked Iron Man, and then you spun it out from there. So it's like for everybody, everybody's going to need to like this first Star Wars movie to get not only the next two, but also whatever these spin-off films.
It has to leave more questions than answers, basically. Yeah. And I think that's...
That, well, that's... I mean, listen, if we're dealing with J.J. Abrams, I think there's one superpower he has, it is oftentimes frustratingly asking questions.
There'll be a polar bear in the movie just halfway through for no reason.
Which, so, through friends of friends, I know the Red Letter Media guys.
Oh, yeah?
And they were telling a story of when Lindelof first tweeted, from Lost, first tweeted the Plinkett review, and it went from like zero to 60. Now all of a sudden it's all over everywhere, and everyone, they're out of this bar, and people are like congratulating them and everything, and it's a bunch of film nerds and everything they're hanging out with, and they were terrified.
Yes.
They thought that this was going to be, now if it's just a, everybody inside message boards or whatever, nobody cares. If it's big time, it's getting millions or hundreds of millions of views, now all of a sudden it's a problem
because
it puts them in the crosshairs.
You've got your head above the parapet.
George Lucas, which they are, like, as anybody who's seen it, merciless with.
I'm pretty sure that's what he was referencing when he said, you know, when he claimed that he was retiring and not producing any more Star Wars and there would never be any more. And he said, why would I make any more when everyone shouts at you all the time and tells you what a horrible person
you are? This is the Plinkett.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure he meant Plinkett was shouting it. I'm pretty sure he's seen it. I mean, why wouldn't you?
If everyone's talking. Oh, my God. I've definitely watched the Plinkett review more than The Phantom Menace itself. I think I've seen the Plinkett review four or five times, and I don't think I made it through The Phantom Menace more than twice.
I mean, as part of writing this book, but also for fun, I think I watched through all of the Plinkett reviews twice. They're really just brilliant. And it doesn't seem to work for, I mean, I watched the Star Trek ones. They were okay.
Well, the Star Trek ones felt just a little bit overly pedantic, like nitpicky stuff, you know? Whereas his review of Titanic is amazing because he spends the first half of the review making a very compelling case for why it's one of the best Hollywood movies of all time. Then he spends the second half of the review making a very compelling case for why it's one of the crappiest Hollywood movies of all time. It's really good.
I love it.
Well, I think, you know, that Mike Skolska, I believe his name is, they obviously have, and the guys that he works with, like, have a really good idea for film. And Lucas just seems to be, he's a more interesting film study, right? Because he's got a very weird sort of body of work that's obviously dominated by this one large 800-pound gorilla. He is not, hasn't exactly proven his hand, like Spielberg or Cameron or anything in terms of, you know, like the Cameron reviews, both for Titanic and Avatar, do a really great job of pointing out, here are all these really big, gigantic flaws and holes. Mm-hmm. And here's why they really kind of don't matter, because it's a simple story. Everybody can grasp, and he gets great performances out of his actors. Yep. And Lucas, on one hand, you know, you have, certainly you get the feeling that he got everything that he possibly could get out of Harrison Ford and Mark Hamill and Carrie Fisher in Star Wars, and then you have this buffet of talent in the prequels that is so just languished and wasted. You know, it's just so interesting that he's the same guy that did all that stuff.
I feel like they should just take that. That should be the one and only case study in casting school, if there is such a thing. Is, you know, you take episode one and be like, you know, look, this is why you need chemistry between the actors. It's not about the names. It's about the chemistry.
Yeah. Or, I mean, yeah, but even when, you know, like, they're not really interacting with anybody, you know, it's just sort of like, well, all right, I guess we're standing in this room talking.
I'm staring at this green screen. I'm staring at a post-it note, and I'm going to look very seriously in this direction. Yes. A monotone.
Are you going to be at a Star Wars celebration?
I will, yes.
We'll be there too. They're going to show Revenge of the Sith in 3D there too, which...
That'll be
really interesting.
Yeah, but you know, it's
higher ground.
It's right not to see the shot reverse shot.
Oh, jeez. hey, Chris, have you been surprised at the reaction that you've gotten for your book? Or did you feel like you were onto something? You know, sometimes it's like you do something, you're like, I suspect this is really good, and as you send it out.
I hope.
This is really good.
That's exactly. That was the soundtrack of me writing it.
Like, oh, my God. Oh,
my God, this is genius.
Where did they get a load of this?
This is on the keyboard.
You know, it would come and go in days. I think, you know, some days I'd be like, I'm writing out of shit. What is this? What is coming out of my keyboard? But, you know, no, I mean, especially towards the end, it felt pretty good. And I was just, you know, hoping that... that people would read it and just sort of not, because what often happens with books is, you know, a narrative emerges about what the book is or what it's about, you know, without people actually reading it. I think you just hope as an author that people actually take the time to look through it and, you know, not necessarily believe the narrative, but the narrative has been pretty good. You know, the reviews have been positive. You know, I loved what IO9 had to say about it, for example. You know, the New Yorker, I never expected to get that sort of recognition for it at all. But yeah, you know, it's been an encouraging start. And of course, the paperback will be coming out later this year. And
New stuff in the paperback?
There will be new stuff in the paperback.
Oh, great.
And tease any kind of new stuff?
There will be mentions of the name of episode 7. No, obviously.
I'll do tell.
Be a little bit more advanced.
There might be a lightsaber, maybe a little different.
There may be a hilt. I would love to add more stuff to the entire book. I mean, writing it was like every chapter could have been a book by itself. And I had to make massive decisions about what to leave out. I'd love to bring some of that stuff back in. I'm toying with the idea of calling the paperback the special edition.
Oh, I love it.
Which, you know, I don't know if that would help
play
sales.
Play to the base. You got to do it. Everybody will love it.
I want to have one chapter where just something's completely turned around, right?
Yeah, exactly.
You know, and then, you know, people be like, no, you got to get the hardback. That was the best version. That was the original.
You got to read it in order, right? Yeah. You know, you got to take the first few chapters out of the special edition.
Yeah, and, yeah. I want to clamp down on hardback sales and then just have people, sneaking like despecialized hardback editions.
You should just have random stormtroopers just like peeking out from the back of like certain words,
We just add X-wing fighters on different pages randomly. Just coming in. Yeah.
I was going to ask you something and I totally forgot about it.
Do we want to jump to an after things?
This,
I mean, you tell me what we want to do. I don't know. By all means, let's do that. Chris, can you hang around or do you have to go or what's your schedule?
If I could just take a moment to make a call, I can do that.
I'm gonna I'll do a quick bio break and check on the kids real quick.
There's a restroom break, so
yeah, I'm just gonna sit here and just talk to everybody. Hi guys, how are you? I hope everybody liked the episode. I felt like that was really good. If you didn't like it, then don't tell me. Yeah, sorry early on the lobs. We tried to sound check that early with Nesh, and for whatever reason it didn't hold up. I did turn them off, which I feel like is a mistake. Like if something's working technically, I feel like you should always just leave it going. I try to turn stuff off. Yeah, I don't know whether it was. Wait, does it not sound like I'm on the PR40? I'm definitely on the PR40. Lots of room. Oh, no, that's this mic. This mic has like crazy, crazy, crazy room echo.
All right, man, I'm back. Here to save your butt.
Welcome back, man. How'd you like our interview?
I wrote a book, like the most awesome like nonfiction book I think I've ever read, you know? So
I can't, I mean, I will. And people said, no, you can, but I can't go on how much, like, how much an ear treat that book was, just because, you know, the fact he talked about each chapter could be its own book. It felt like that. It felt like there was no filler, zero. It was just this engaging. Oh, he's here. Oh, it was horrible. It was horrible.
See, you know what, it's actually something that I was reading another nonfiction book about pro wrestling, and it was called, it's the WCW. So it's all about this one thing, but it did something. It didn't make a decision that you made in telling a narrative story, or sorry, a timeline kind of story. You, especially in focusing it more on the fandom and sort of like what the cultural impact of Star Wars was, every time that we were at a very natural break in kind of the origin story of either George Lucas or Star Wars or the productions themselves, there was like, okay, well, here's another little spotlight on something that's happened about it, or somebody that came out of this production that you can tell this sort of, you know, one chapter version of their story. And it did such a great job of not only breaking up the fatigue of like, okay, and now he's in production, and now he's stressed out, and now he's dealing with it, and now he's in production, and now he's stressed out, and now he's dealing with it. That, you know, I think a lot of other nonfiction books that are kind of telling a timed story just don't. It just felt like, and in the other book, it's a story about a company going out of business. Mm. It's just this funeral dirge of like, and then they fucked up, and then they fucked up, and then they fucked up, and then they fucked up. And it's like not really any element of like, hey, look, and here's something about this, or here's something that came out of it, or here's this little spotlight. Like, was that something that you made a decision on early on to do?
For sure, yeah. I mean, I get, as a book reader myself, I get very easily distracted, so I wanted to avoid any way of that being a problem. You know, and initially I had the plan of doing it as, I mean, the subtitle of the book is The Past, Present, and Future of a Multi-Billion-Dollar Franchise. Mm-hmm. I did sort of initially want to go have a section on the past and have a section on the present, talk about the 501st Legion.
Yeah.
Yeah. And the R2 builders and that sort of stuff, and then talk about the future. As you say, it just seemed like one long narrative that you know was unbending, and it sort of, you know, and Lucas builds up, and he comes up through film school, and he has his first idea, and that, you know. And that would seem too much like a biography as well.
I love that you got off your ass. At the very beginning, I'm first like, is it a Navajo Indian reservation? What is this about? And then I get pulled into it, and then I get the framing device, and then you're chasing down an octogenarian Darth Vader to track down a rumor. I'm like, oh my God. And I can tell how uncomfortable you were with the idea of this, but this was a last chance to know. Next thing you know, you're in, you know, stormtrooper armor. And I'm like, this is, I get tired of these, you know, of biographies that you read that it's either just somebody got every book that's already been written, sat down in front of it and wrote a book condensing that, which is a problem because you're like, man, I've read those books. There's no original thing here. Or, you know, the one where it's the person, journalists can often make very horrible biographers or people tell these stories because they just sit there with their notepad. Then they just go ask somebody else. And then you get this sort of, you know, a glued together transcript of what took place, but not really trying to find the truth of what happened. And yeah,
I think so. Two things happened when I discovered that there had not really been a complete history of Star Wars, and that, you know, I there was an opening here to write a book about that. One was, you know, yay, this is fantastic, and the other one was, oh shit, this is really, you know, that's a heavy responsibility to write that book because everyone is going to be on your case, and you really have to do justice to this whole thing, this franchise, to, you know, to the 501st Legion. Trying to do justice to the 501st Legion in a single chapter is phenomenally stressful.
Considering some of the infighting and controversy. And I'm sure you didn't want to seem like you were coming in on anybody's side on that.
Yeah, I barely didn't even want to get into that. I mean, I wanted the whole book to be a positive history.
Yeah.
That's what I was aiming for. And, I loved... Yeah, and I wanted there to be more scenes in it where you're just sort of on the ground, like, you know, going to the first screening of Navajo Star Wars and talking about the
it was,
you know, using that as a jumping off point.
Well,
to talk
let's
about.
Let's go ahead and start officially start after thing. I'm sorry, Brian.
Oh no, that's fine. I just wanted to say that it did a fantastic job. It was a very humanizing set of stories. You know, like every single character became a person to me, and in a way that none of the news stories or other biographies really had. I thought, but after things, what we usually do is we talk a little bit about the creative process and about sort of peel back the curtain about the journeys that we're all on as we try to grow and develop a brand and presence and stuff. It's a bit of a meta thing, but I would imagine that you have some fantastic insights that we'd love to pick your brains on.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, this is After Things. I'm Andrew Main, joined by Justin Robert Young.
Hi.
Brian Brushwood.
Yo.
And we got him to stick around, author of How Star Wars Conquered the Universe, deputy editor of Mashable. I guess he went to Oxford or something, too. And actually, I want you to talk a little bit, too, at some point about the Helping Kids Learn to Read So Good charity that you're involved with, too. Chris Taylor.
That's a fantastic title for a charity. Helping kids to learn
Zoolander.
To talk.
Helping
kids
also, to read. It's also, it's a writing, right? The 826 Valencia.
826 Valencia after school program started in San Francisco and then just sort of exploded across the country.
It's amazing if you're
involved with that.
Mm.
What was that?
Correct. That was Dave Eggers is involved with that.
Of course.
Yes.
And if you are ever out here in San Francisco, you need to stop by the physical 826 Valencia because it is a pirate supply store.
Yes.
The front of it is all supplies for the modern pirate. You can walk in and get all your ropes and
it has been described as probably the second best pirate supply store in San Francisco.
Yes, indeed.
David Byrne has a quote about that. You can see it as you go in.
That's so great.
But no, it's fantastic. I mean, there's the time travel store is in Seattle, I believe, and then you have
the superhero store in Brooklyn.
There's one in L.A. They're just exploding, and it's such a great idea that you hook the kids in with that kind of fantastic, you know, actually functioning pirate supply store.
Sure,
they will
really supply your pirate ass. That's a real thing.
And you get a little bit further back, and then there's this wonderful large writing room where you know you can go get help with your homework, or you can, what I was involved in was helping to found a newspaper written by kids for kids,
great.
Bayfarer. I love 826 Valencia. Everyone should get involved and give money and. Go check out your local 826.
You think one of the biggest things that can hold back really talented young people is the ability to express themselves.
Yes.
And doing this program I'm so glad to see that you're taking your skills, your person as a journalist, as a writer, you have this, and you're going to help kids who maybe never had the opportunity to work with a great teacher or maybe had teachers that didn't have the time to help them understand how to do that. And being trapped inside your own head is frustrating, and the ability to articulate and explain things is a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful thing. And the ability to express yourself in the written form is increasingly more important than it was before. And so much of our communications from social media to email, et cetera, the better you're at it, the more succinct you are, unlike I am right now, but you know, the more effective you're going to be in life. And so I think it's a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful organization to be involved with. Now, how many local chapters are there of 826? Do you have any idea?
That's a good question. I think every time I answer that, it's wrong because they've opened another one.
But you can go to 826national.org, 826.national, and find out a bit more about the program. And actually, I'm looking here, and I can see there's an LA one, which I'm going to go find out more about now. There's Chicago, Michigan, D.C., Boston, and New York City.
To be totally honest, like they're all super rad just to even walk into. Like it is not just kind of like a front for gimmick's sake. There's a lot of attention to detail.
It really gets how kids work, I think, and how their brains work.
I worked. I remember I was living in New York when the Brooklyn one opened, and you know, it's like, oh, there's a superhero supply store opening. I'm like, all right, I'm there.
But one of the best things about doing the newspaper for that was helping kids unlearn, I think, some of the structure that is put on them in English class in school.
Yeah.
Like, you know, with when you do English class, you sort of, you're taught that there's a right way and a wrong way to write an essay, right?
Yeah.
You know, there's a certain structure, a certain way you have to do things. And the greatest thing for me is the light bulb going off above kids' heads where they realize that the journalism isn't that. The journalism is just about following your curiosity. And if you're curious about something, you just write about it and you just ask people about it.
Yeah.
It really just changes their minds and in a heartbeat. And I've seen some really great work come out of just that realization.
I was just at a school for kids who are autistic. Mm. And, you know, I used Star Wars to break down story structure for them because it was a common point, it was a reference point they had because they were asking about character development. And it was interesting to have that sort of touchstone, like, I knew it, these kids knew it, and so we could use those sort of examples. And then for these kids, talk to them a bit about two-sentence short stories and just the idea of trying to get the clear idea of conflict or resolution or that. But it's a very rewarding thing. It's very, very rewarding because, you know, I find for me, the more I articulate this, the more I tend to understand these things a little bit more myself when trying to take things I think I know but maybe I don't and trying to explain it. I'm like, oh, wait, maybe I don't know why we do this.
Mm.
So, speaking of, do you have pat advice that you give folks who want to be writers or get started? Like, do you have? I would imagine a number of people ask you, like, "Hey, you're doing what I want to do." Do you have some go-to instructions?
Start a blog. Just write. I mean, one of the favorite pieces of writing advice I've ever heard, and it's maybe apocryphal because I can't remember exactly who gave it, was a guy who supposedly comes into a university to give a creative writing class. And the only thing he says is, "What are you all doing here? Go home and write until your butts fall off." You know, and I think that's just what you need to do. Just do it over and over again. You know, it may not be the Malcolm Gladwell 10,000 hours theory, but it is a case of, you know, you get better the more that you do it, and the more that you see your work published and out there, and the more you get feedback on it. And the best way to do that is to write a blog. And maybe blogs are a little old-fashioned these days. I never thought I'd say that.
So old.
But, you know, or write a post on Medium or whatever. It doesn't even...
Are you a fan of the way most people are using Twitter these days? Because I've seen somebody talking about how... I got offended when somebody said, Twitter has this unfair constraint that causes people to use bad abbreviations and encourages bad writing. Whereas I find the exact opposite. I find that Twitter's 140 character constraint forces me to convey bigger ideas with a brevity that I normally wouldn't be able to do. I will go through like four revisions of a tweet in order to get it to fit and say like, yes, that says what I want with the right amount of
yes. And then the best tweets are often under 140 characters. They're often, you know, just one quick sentence long. Maybe they're just 70 characters long. You know, it's the best tweets just sort of come out and you know, you don't have to revise them very much. And brevity is definitely the soul of wit. So I think Twitter is a great teacher of that, but I think it is also encouraging a little bit too much cynicism in our society.
It's a hell of a lot easier to throw some snark out on Twitter than to put out some sunshine. That's for damn sure.
You know, you mentioned his advice: get out there, write, and blog. And then, you know, one of the things is trying to figure out how to get feedback. But a great source of that can often be before you even need to go to that stage. And you pointed this out. And writing How Star Wars Conquered the Universe was at the thought of how are the super fans going to react to this? And you could imagine that the critics in your head were probably far more severe than the ones you're going to experience. But just thinking from that point of view, just changing, you know, your kind of theory of mind to be somebody that way can be very helpful.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, you've always got to have an audience in your head when you're writing, I think. And, you know, otherwise you're just... You know, writing for yourself is a horrible idea, I think. I mean, it's on the one
so even,
level.
Even for the one person who's writing their blog, they're taking your advice. They started a blog. They went back to, you know, 2003 when everybody was doing it. And now they're writing a blog.
Yeah.
Like, even then, you got to think about who you're writing for and it's not just yourself.
Yeah. I mean, you know, definitely write it. The subject should be something that you would want to read something on. I think that's essential. But yeah, I mean, always have an idea of a reader who is not you. If that's your grandmother or your brother or your best friend. You know, just imagine that you are talking directly to them.
It's funny because, like, to hear it in the context of writing, it almost feels like, no, of course you should write for yourself or whatever. But any other form of communication, you wouldn't think, you don't speak just to hear yourself talk. You speak so that you can communicate effectively. And it's extremely important that you pay attention to whether or not your message is resonating with them. So to make the effort to do that with writing makes a lot of sense.
Yeah, the biggest problem that first-time writers have is they tend to use words that are way too long and sentences that are way too long.
I mean, did you ever read Stephen King's book on writing?
Yes, love that book. Great advice.
So good. I never understood that adverbs were the devil until he wrote that. The other thing that I took away from that was he says his best advice for writing is read. And he says, if you don't have time to read, you don't have the time or the tools to write. Simple as that, which always stuck with me as well.
I would just tell Stephen King, you know what? Outlines aren't the devil either, though.
Endings aren't the devil.
Yeah. One of my favorite books I ever read was The Art of Readable Writing by Rudolf Flesch, which was very counter to, in when your normal English classes, you're taught, this is right, this is wrong. And Art of Readable Writing talked about how sometimes somebody who has a very different voice or different way of talking, don't change that. You know, a Southerner or some aspect like that. And some of the most powerful writing you have is people who speak in their own voice. And I go back and forth as my editor sometimes. She'll say, like, oh, you know, you want to change, it's in the when somebody's talking, they'll say, no, that's not the proper way to use literal or whatever. I'm like, I know, but my character's not an English major. You know, my character's not this. They're going to use these terms. They might repeat words or do things where it may not sound, as well as if it had been written in a proper way, but I want to kind of show a difference in education. And so sometimes I'll do those things differently.
Yeah, worrying about grammar is the death of good writing. It really is. I mean, you've got many drafts later on where you can go back and fix that sort of stuff, but focus on what you're trying to get across. And get it across in as few words as possible. I mean, Winston Churchill always had this maxim about no sentence should be longer than 10 words. Yeah. You know, like a lot of rules about writing, that's more honored in the breach than the observance. But it's a really good, it's a good sort of general thing to aim for. You know, write short and write as if you are talking to someone directly. One of the best exercises in journalism school I ever heard about, it's actually a friend of mine who's a J-school teacher, said that she would get her students to just sit down and tell them what this story was getting them to imagine they're sitting at their dining table at the end of the day and they are describing to their partner or their roommate or whoever they live with, you know, just what was the story that you did today? What was the news that you tackled? Imagine that. And she will even get them to, you know, close their eyes and, you know, create a breeze. Everyone in the room flaps their pieces of paper to create a breeze that's coming in from the window as you're sitting there at the dining table. That's what you've got to imagine. It's once you get that, it's so easy. It is really, you know, writing is writing well, it should feel like cheating because it should come that easily because you are just conversing with the reader.
So Neshcom and a few other people in the chat room are pointing out, does your idea of writing for an audience, was that informed by news writing?
I think that news writing is definitely a good discipline for that. I think it's also informed by editing because you get to see so many other pieces of work and you start to learn what works and what doesn't work in that. And certainly sub-editing is a thing in British journalism, which is where I started out. And that's where you actually rewrite the reporter in the voice of the publication.
Gotcha.
Publications have very specific voices. So learning that was very helpful as well. But really, at the end of the day, I'm very sort of punk rock about this. It's like, you know, you just learn your three chords and go into your garage and just do it.
Express your rage instantly. One thing that I would imagine, having a journalism background, and I assume this is the case for Justin as well, because he was editor-in-chief of iTrix,
Let's forget the Daily Orange at Syracuse.
Is that having a deadline short circuits that urge that so many of us have to edit as we write. One of the best pieces of advice I ever got was turn off the monitor. And because what you want to do is you start to type and then you're like, no, that's not right. And instead, if you turn off the monitor, you are forced to just keep going. If you make a mistake, then you know that will be handled in the editing phase of things. But your job right now is to just barf it all out, get it all over there, restate as much as you have to, and get started. Like, did you go through a transition, kind of, you know, pre-journalism, post-journalism, as far as, or were you always able to just translate the thoughts in your head into words on the page?
Yeah, I think I probably found it easier than most just to start out. But I still, you know, I went through that phase of, you know, we call it killing your darlings or drowning your kittens. I think there was a very influential teacher at journalism school called Judith Crist. She was a great film critic of the 60s and 70s and very well known. And she did this class called Personal and Professional Style. And she would just take your stuff and rip it to shreds. And one of the things I always remember her saying is, if you ever write anything and look at it and go, gee, that's good, kill it.
As they say in film, take your favorite scene and get rid of it.
Yeah, absolutely. And you know, that is painful. It's the hardest thing to do because you've fallen in love with that sentence and the way it's written. But if it doesn't work, if it isn't advancing the story, if it isn't telling the reader anything, kill it.
I've always found that idea, though, is in itself kind of a meta idea. Because in any writing that I've done or any editing, like it's far easier when you are the editor to say, yeah, this doesn't work. Like, this is boring. This is stupid. Or like, this connects way better to this if you just take this out, than it is for somebody, especially starting writing. You almost have to develop this sense of outer self to understand what your darlings even are before you can kill them. Like, because it was you know, that obviously is very prevalent advice, and I remember just being kind of confused by it, or like looking for random things that, like, the more I got into writing, the more I realized, like, oh, no. I'm not just looking to kill something that I kind of like. I'm looking to kill something that I feel is maybe indispensable that I have overvalued.
Yeah. It does take a while to figure out how you're reacting to a sentence in your head. But after a while, you do sort of start to notice, oh, yeah, that's... it's just actually my ego that loves that sentence.
Or that there's this idea that you love. Yeah. Where it's like, let's say, I mean, and to use an example just in terms of the context of what we did, like, you know, if in this book you had a great interview with something that just didn't fit for, you know, the book, but you have this attachment, you would like keep it in for as long as you possibly can because, you know, it's like, oh, but this guy's so great and he gave me such great stuff and he wasn't guarded and he was open. But it just doesn't belong.
Yeah.
You know, it just, everything is going to be better.
Yeah. And film, often the reason you do that is because your inability to judge it, because like, we spent 3 days on set trying to get this 45-second shot and it just doesn't work. And then writing, it's like, yeah, I waited in the airport for 5 hours to meet with this person and finally I got it. And it's hard because your value isn't what's in front of you. It's everything behind it that the reader or the viewer will never see. They'll never know that's there.
It's the sunk cost fallacy,
absolutely,
right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's because you invested so much time and effort. So it occurs to me, like, I don't know. I just assume that my situation is different from yours, Andrew's, and yours, Chris's. All the books I have written have been because I have seen a market opportunity for them, unabashed. Like, you know, I learned to eat fire and I was like, I want the best book in the business for eating fire. And I realized that there wasn't one. So I was like, oh, well, there's an opportunity. I could be an author and I could be the guy who wrote the definitive guide to fire eating. Scam School comes out, you know, we do Scam School and it's like, well, you know, we have this product, that's the show. It seems like there should be a complimentary book. So it's like I recognize the voids and then go to fill them. But I'm assuming that's not how you guys do it. I would love to hear from both of you, like, where you decide to turn your attention to write towards. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's something I tackle every day at Mashable because I write a lot of opinion pieces and a lot of analysis pieces, and it's often a case where there is a subject that has been discussed, but you can just sort of see the one thing that people are not saying, and you get really furious that people are not saying this one thing. They're not. Why are they not seeing it this way? You know, and that's a good sign that you should really get out and write. I mean, Christopher Hitchens, by the way, another great writing book, Letters to a Young Contrarian. He talks about this idea of he read the New York Times every morning not to get informed, but to get his blood boiling. He disagreed with a lot of their how they approach the world and their voice and their perspective.
I can't remember. I want to say it was a Genie magazine article written by Penn and or Teller where they say, don't let love be your guiding force when it comes to creating. If you do, the best you will be is a pale imitation of whatever it is you love. If instead, let hate be your guiding force. Figure out everything you hate in magic and then be the opposite of those things. And then and you will, number one, it'll be something that's unique to you, but it'll be honest and true.
I think that's one of those weird, mushy kinds of pieces of advice because if you define yourself as what you're not, it's hard to be something new.
Well, no. Like, I don't know. Google's mantras, don't be evil. That's a very carefully
crafted.
How'd
that work out for them?
I mean, it seems to be working out pretty great so far, and they're coming out with some very not evil stuff.
We'll talk about mission creep on another podcast. But I would say that, like, I understand that, but I think that, but once you say, well, I, and again, by the way, I'm not going to take away anyway from, I love the idea of the Christopher Hitchens blood boiling thing, and we're big Hitchens fans here. Let me make that very clear. I think that there's everybody's approach is going to be different. I would say, like, to the earlier question, how I chose, like, I started writing science fiction, and I liked it. It was fun, and I had a nice response to it, but I realized that market was only so big. And I said, okay, do I want to write to a bigger market? And the answer was yes. And I looked at what was out there and I realized that, you know what? There's a big market for vampires. There's a big market for teenage girl dystopia. I don't have anything to say there. I have nothing to contribute there. And I'm not going to force myself to sit down and write something in there. But there was other areas, thrillers and stuff. I said, no, I'd like to write a thriller. I'd like to take what I love about sci-fi and put that in there. And I would, you know, going back to what I would say, like some of my books, I would say to your point though, Brian, were things I said, no, this isn't being done right, or I don't like the way they're doing this, so I'm going to do this. But I mean, hate is a word I just don't like. I hate the word.
Sure. Well, and I understand that is a powerful word and maybe too powerful for this, but like,
I think it's a desire to put it right, you know, to put things right, to put the universe in its right place. You know, we talk about putting the world to rights in late night conversations. I think that's the spirit we're really talking about.
I'll tell you, in both those examples, Teller, Penn and Teller, and Christopher Hitchens, them describing their process is to me much like, you know, Zeus describing how he likes to take breakfast or something. I mean, they are both. I mean, Hitchens obviously to such a voluminous at times even like effortless list kind of writer. You know, I think there's so much to learn. You know, but wow, like both of them are just like intense creative machines.
Justin, remember the lesson Hitchens gave you about wine? What's worse than this wine?
So We got a chance to meet Hitchens. I mean, I don't know if Andrew got to meet him more than once, but he was at the amazing meeting, James Randi's amazing meeting. This is the third one that they did out in Las Vegas, and Hitchens is invited. And I, because Andrew used to work with the organization, get to go to their speakers.
By the way, just because we haven't said it on the podcast, I think we talked about it on Twitter. Strangely, in a bizarre, you know, confluence of events, I was at that amazing meeting because I was about to start doing my skeptical lecture. So all three of us were in the same room at the same time, only I would not come to meet and become BFFs with these guys for another 5 years. Yeah.
For years, yeah. So we're sitting there, and Andrew.
Where are we sitting, Justin?
We are sitting right next to. Well, we are off to the side, and then all of a sudden there's this reshuffling, and Andrew's like,
wait, no, Dustin, a TGI Fridays in a casino.
Oh, God, yes. No. It was a Ruby Tuesdays. A Ruby Tuesdays in the Stardust, which I think was destroyed, and I forget what it is now. But it is a Ruby Tuesdays. So we are sitting there. Andrew, go ahead and pushes me, and I'm sitting next to Chris Fridge, a hero of mine, hero of Andrew's. And, yes, we're in a Ruby Tuesdays. Of course, as you imagine, meeting Christopher Hitchens at a Ruby Tuesdays in Las Vegas is just, he's like, flags down the waitress. The waitress is like, oh, would you like to drink? He's like, yes, wine. He's like, red or white? And he just stares in that, like, this that piercing kind of, like, especially if you go watch any of his debates, he just has these, like, this look of, like, can you be any dumber? Like, you know, just sort of, like, boring sort of look that he has. He just looks her right in the face and just goes, wine is red. There we go. Brings in the red wine. And I'm like, oh, so do you like the wine? And he goes, it's terrible. It's sheep dip. It's almost as bad as if there were no wine at all.
Wow.
And that's it. And that's my Christopher Hitchens story. But I feel like anybody who's a fan of his work is just...
He cultivated that personality.
Though. Oh, I mean, that's good. I know.
He definitely, I mean, and this is part and parcel of it. If you feel like you have something to say, then you will. If you feel like you are a good writer, you will be it. I mean, you know, as long as you're self-aware enough to be killing your darlings, you know, you can be one of these guys. It is, you know, they're just human beings.
Oh, certainly so. Yeah, and not to say that they are, you know, in any way unattainable, you know, places, but it's just one of those things that you got to recognize that in the D&D game of life, you are of a certain level and they are of another level. And it's not to say that you cannot level up.
You can definitely level up.
It's not to say that you can't climb that ladder, but it is, I mean, that's why the best lesson you can do is just go do it because it's going to be a wild card for you.
Yeah.
And like, you know, like Brian's like turn off the screen thing. Like that's insane to me. You know, like
Luke, you've turned off your targeting computer. Is anything wrong?
And that might be really, really good advice, like for a lot of people. And it might be good if you can't get through the point where you're.
I would say a more modern version of that is get a Bluetooth keyboard connected to your phone, not to like an iPad or anything. Just stick the phone over there on the table so you can sort of vaguely see where you're typing.
And go back to it. Yeah. But I guess so much of like where I learned to have any kind of writing skill was in newspaper writing on deadline. And it's like, you need, it's like what my lesson that I had to learn was that you have to confront your self-loathing like head on. Like you have to understand, listen, you are the shittiest writer ever. Also, your story's due in a half hour. So like, let's get this shitty dance on so like we can have something in the paper for your editor decapitates
you. You do have to have a certain self-confidence though. I think telling yourself that you're the shittiest writer ever will produce shitty writing. So that's my
feeling. I mean, I guess it's just one thing where it's like, just own up to the feelings. Like, oh yeah, you have the feeling, acknowledge the feeling, go.
And people are interested. People want to read your shitty feelings. Whatever they are.
That two elements kind of coming together. We talked about the idea of anger or hatred as a guiding force, the dark side of artistry, I guess. But then also, I remember Justin gave me a quote, I'm sure mangled, by way of Adam Carolla about Jimmy Kimmel, talking about like what motivates him.
Well, no, yeah, that quote was that, you know, Jimmy Kimmel, you know, now late night host for many, many years, would just fall into a malaise if four people that he worked with through his career would just apologize to him. Like, you know, or just say they were wrong about firing him. That's so much as it, like, he wakes up every day and it's like that one station manager in Phoenix, like, I hope they really... I hope they really taste it tonight when I interview Jennifer Aniston and just show how awesome I am.
Which girlfriends. It's like that stuff is going to stick with you. Nobody knows what's going on inside your head. But I think fundamentally it's very helpful to remember that we're all, you know, I don't want to get too touchy-feely, but we're all more the same than we are different, right? So that when you're writing something about the way that you see a story – you know, chances are you can hook into something that we all understand if we don't feel it ourselves, but you can make us feel it.
This leads into my question to everyone here, and you don't have to give specifics. In fact, I encourage you not to give specifics, but does anyone here, how about, let me phrase it this way. Does anyone else here have an arch nemesis, an arch villain in their life who every time you work hard and make better, beautiful poetry and have success, in your private heart of hearts, you're sticking the middle finger in their face? Because I have like two or three, and it's not healthy, except insofar as, like, I guess, you know, something good is coming of it. But I can't help but keep thinking whatever. Like, is that a shared experience?
Sure. Yeah. I mean, I think, you know, it's like everything else. You can focus more on that or less on that, and the more you. The more you focus on it, the more it will dominate your destiny.
Well, I think
Star Wars lines here, but
it really is a personality thing for me. Mm. Like, I mean, if there are certainly an element of my creative drive that is defiance based, you know, and it, at times it is helpful to activate that element, you know. Mm. But no matter what, and even when I say, like, oh, you have to if you feel like you're going to write something that's crap, you know, you have to acknowledge that feeling. Mm. The second part of that is, like, and make peace and conquer it. You know,
yes.
Like, for me, it's always been very helpful for me to acknowledge where my self-loathing is so I can find out where it ends. And I can understand when it comes up, when it doesn't come up, where it is more acute. You know, if there are things that I can do, it's like, maybe it happens a lot when I don't prepare as much. So how about this? Let me prepare a little bit more. And maybe these feelings don't hit me at times when they are vital. But that was the biggest element for me was, you know, in terms of whether I was my own worst enemy or even looking like at other people that if I like channel, like, oh my God, I'm going to do this awesome because this other person didn't think I could do it. It has to end at the point where you're really creating. Mm. I think it's helpful to me to start a thing. It's not helpful when I'm creating it. It's not helpful when I'm in the process of making it, because that has to, for me at least, be its own kind of pure experience.
Mm. One of my favorite lines, and I think it's guided me throughout life as well as throughout writing, is, and I forget which 3,000-year-old philosopher wrote it, but it's, be kind because everyone you meet is fighting a heart battle.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think that just that revelation, just that sort of empathy, and you know that's certainly the kind of thing that, to bring it back to Star Wars, that Lucas is sort of trying to get at in that series, is like more empathetic you are, the better.
I'm gonna double down on that, because, like, I don't have a nemesis. I mean, there are people who don't like me. There are people who don't care, but it doesn't matter to me. The only people who I would think who have ever wished me ill will are not happy people. You know, they're not people that I even think much, you know, have to worry about or whatever, because they're not people who are living fulfilled lives. They're not people who have a lot of friends and living in rich things. I have my pity. And you know, there's not a person I wouldn't sit down to next to at a bar, no matter how horrible things they said to me, and not have a friendly conversation with. Because, you know, it's like if I walk into a kindergarten and a kid calls me a name, it's not going to ruin my day. You know, it's just it's.
And by the way, Andrew was definitely the genesis.
Your nemesis, we can admit it.
No. Wait. The genesis of probably the healthiest transformation I had in my adult life, in that you know, there's a scarcity mentality among magicians about, like, there's only so many people who can be the famous TV magician or whatever. And it was Andrew that says, like, look, somebody else's success does nothing but open more doors to your success. So it's like, you should be, you know, magic should be so popular on television that everybody's scrambling to find their magician to get on. If what you want to do is get on TV, then you should hope that the latest David Blaine special is more popular than the last one. And that's certainly correct.
And you don't want to win a game that's a stacked game. How do you feel good about that? And I mean, I heard something the other day, I don't know if it was Kissinger or whatever, who said, "The smaller the pie, the sharper the knives."
Yes, I love that.
And I don't know. I never sit there going, "Oh, if I could show so and so," because, you know, so and so, like, I can name some so and so's that are not happy people, and I wish they were happy people, and their ability to hurt me or whatever. Maybe it's because, like, I have, like, I don't know. My background is, like, you know, my dad is my hero. I live up to my dad. I made my dad proud. I won.
Man, I'll tell you what. That's noble and right, and you're 100% spot on. but there are three MFers out there that I need to really show
them.
But
they have control over you, though. It's giving them power that you don't want them to have.
What's funny is it's not even them. It's their legend is who I'm spitting back at. You know, it's like I will never speak to any of those three people again. But the image of what they were and what they represented to me is what motivates me to work harder, make better art, and try more. And
why can't you be the bigger guy that could speak to them, because you're that much bigger that it doesn't matter, that it's like
let me
speak in defense. And also, Chris, if you need to get out of here at any moment,
I do have a deadline approaching. Okay, speaking of deadlines,
so feel free if you want to get out of here whenever you get a chance. But just to finish this thought, in defense of Brian's nemesis, I think at times it can be helpful if these ideas in your head are really just personal kind of exemplifications of a lesson you learned.
Mm.
You know, like a point in your life where something happened and you learned a very valuable lesson, and this idea, this person
represents
the personification of it. And then they're not a real people. If you saw them on the street, you'd say hi and you know,
exactly, probably. Exactly. Like Brian, the person, would never say something rude to the nemesis, the person. However, Brian, the artist, in thinking of this person that represents the personifications of, you know, whatever it is I need to overcome, you know, yeah, dude, I'm going to imagine beating the crap out of him.
You know, I think we all have conversations in the shower with, you know, people who have wronged us or people who...
I'm still having that argument. Yeah.
Didn't quite get the right end of the stick of what we were saying. And I think that is a universal human trait, that we have those conversations, and it's usually in the shower because that's when we're, you know, not thinking or distracted by anything else. Sure. Right. I do think that happens. I think that energy can be taken in a positive direction. And
stop dodging the question. Do you have a nemesis?
I think you said yeah, right? You said
sure. The world is just littered with nemeses. Yeah. You know, especially if you're writing for any sort of website, you get the comments that you get. Never read the comments section. That's rule number one.
Man. Yeah.
But like, Chris, you know the face of these commentators, but the people you know what these people are. It's not some guy who's at the top of his life, really successful, captain of everything, and friends, and getting laid every night, sitting there and writing this stuff. That's not who's doing this.
Yes. It's, you know, it's some guy in a basement, or it's, yeah, you know.
Look at Gamergate, and some of the stuff, some of the biggest criticisms, some of the most vile things you said, and you start following their Twitter feeds, and you realize most of them are 14 or 15-year-old boys, you know, and it's this big war was built over this thing, and you realize, like, man, this is a war with 15-year-old autistics.
Yeah. Yeah, we give that stuff too much power, and we pay way too much attention to it, and I think Gamergate is sort of a classic example of that, in that it really wouldn't have been so much of a thing if we hadn't all sort of kept pointing to the comments section. Hey, look what they're saying now.
Yeah. You know, it's hard. And you know, part of it is also the fact that this whole experience, this whole internet experience, you know, number one, I don't think it's really revealing anything new, you know, that like there are angry, bitter people who would like to spread misfortune and bitterness is not anything new. But at the same time, you know, there is an evolving thought to where the lens, how we refocus the lens on what we want to make a part of the experience. Like for Mashable, I mean, all the big blogs have kind of had evolving thought over the last 10 years on what comments to show. Do you authenticate? Do you not authenticate? Do you go through Facebook? Because this way it's people have to put their real names on it. Do you have comments at all? A lot of blogs have just completely done away with comments and really they don't seem to be any worse for not having them. You know, it's an interesting evolution to, you know, how much do we want to fix it? You know, do we want to deal with it? And that's what I think Gamergate was like, people looking at, you know, a lot of really, really unhappy, angry, young, if not mentally challenged people that were, you know, very, very well worked up about something that, you know, where should a healthy, happy person want to go with that? Should they want to make it better? Should they ignore it? Like, what is our idea on that?
I think you always engage those people. I think it's essential to have that debate. You know, one thing I would love, for example, in another life, I've spent, you know, my entire career in the comments section of climate stories, you know, just responding to every climate denier with the exact science of exactly why they're, you know, I think we've all had that experience of coming through the comment section of a story and going, no, you're wrong. And you know, there's that great XKCD cartoon of, no, I can't leave now. Yeah. Someone is wrong on the internet.
Yeah.
You know, you can spend your whole life on this, and at a certain point, you've got to decide to, you know, put your focus on your own point of view and your own writings.
Yeah.
And just let everyone else. And the danger is, the more you get invested in the battle and the war, the less you get invested in, you know, truth. You know, and that becomes a problem. As I've been involved in the skeptic industry world for years, and just realizing, I just sitting down one day at a conference at a lunch with some of the people and the organizers, and how politicized and how in-group everything was, and it was not about how do we approach these things from thinking about science. It was just, I said, I can't, this is not what I signed up for. You know, we're so invested in oh, that group's wrong, these people are stupid or whatever. And it was just, wasn't healthy.
Mm. Well, guys, I do have to head out. This has been a fantastic conversation.
Dude, this is perfect. Yeah, thank you so much for hanging around for After Things. It was a true honor and joy for all of us to get to gush all over your book right in front of your face. Thank you so much.
I appreciate
it. It was worth it until then, Brian, for him.
I've got to go and have my wife, you know, tell me how useless I am for about an hour just to counteract the effects.
Sure, yeah. I'll tell you what are wives for? Thank you so much for stopping by. And, and again, I mean, you mentioned it, but just so the invitation is officially extended, you are welcome back whenever. Let's follow up and have you back in.
I'd love to come back. Yeah, let's come. Yeah. Let's do this again later in the year.
Fantastic.
Thanks a lot, guys.
Justin and I will be at Star Wars Celebration too. So.
Oh yeah, yeah. No, and actually, we were trying to get Brian to go down there. So maybe if we do.
When is it? I am sitting on a mountain of freaking airline miles, and also I lost my A-list status. So it's like I really want to fly around a bunch just to get back to being one of the special people.
Buy your ticket, bro. It's gonna be
April 16th through 19th.
Okay, right on. I'll be dead broke because that's tax day. But dude, thank you to everybody who stuck with us. It's been after.
Thanks.
Let me go see him out.
So, what do you think about the whole Zelda Netflix?
Oh, I have not heard of this. What's the story?
The rumor is they're working on a Zelda live action.
I am cautious.
We think about this. Everybody wants their Game of Thrones.
There's no way you can make Zelda into a Game of Thrones.
I'm not saying they're going to succeed at it.
I'm saying
everybody wants their Game of Thrones. They want their big sprawling franchise that also has merchandise and other things into it. And fantasy is a great world to do that in. And Zelda is one of the most successful fantasy franchises of all time.
Fair enough. This is very odd. I don't seem to be able to access the disc station.
And Netflix is describing it as Game of Thrones for a family audience. I just read that. I didn't even know that was what they're saying.
I don't know.
I think that, you know, and the goal of Zelda is like there's always the immediate fanboy reaction to it, but the reason they chose this property, certainly because it has a fan base, but it's not for them, it's for the rest of the world, assuming those guys will be along for the ride.
Yes. Hey Justin, thanks for being so flexible on the Audible as far as swapping over the mics. I know it's a real pisser to invest 30 minutes
I'm
in trying to make
because we tried to me and Neshcom were on Skype like a half hour before testing everything and just trying to make sure it was good. And we thought we'd worked everything out. So, you know, it's a work in progress. You know, we had the backup, so that's really all that matters. But
it ended up sounding great. There was a bit of echoey room tone on your mic, but Chris,
that's this mic here.
Yeah, because it's got a long throw, right?
Yeah.
Hey, Justin, do you want to? It sounds like you very rarely need more than two mics in that studio, right?
Check. That I rarely need more than two mics?
Yeah.
Yes. No, I very rarely need more than two mics.
Do you want to buy just another PR-40 out of the Night Attack budget so that and we'll just expense that out?
Yeah. You know, it's been we've been. Is this still? No.
You sound a lot better. Like we can't hear the echo from the walls at all. There's no room tone now.
Yeah, well, because the PR-40s are fucking so much better. you know, I think it is. I don't know. I mean, like we tried to experiment with the lavs just because they look better with the set, and I don't get into my like 90s grunge, like two hands on the mic stance, which is kind of like my normal thing whenever I have a mic or whatever. But I think that'll probably be the way to go. And we can just have all the cords running. Like, just to give you a sense, like we did a bunch of work lighting wise.
Dude, it looks great in there. Everything just really seemed to play well.
We have like a little like thing set up so we can have that stuff there. I don't know. It is a work in progress. So we might as well buy another PR-40. That would probably make the most sense. But then the other thing is just also figuring out exactly what we want to do on this set and whether or not we're probably going to buy two more.
Yeah, I guess you would need a PR-40 and another mic stand. So another like $40 or whatever. I'll tell you what, like, it's so funny to me how many little things continue to evolve. I just got back the replacement flood from Philips Hue because one of my things went out and we replaced it. And so, like, you see this shadow on my face? Like this, here we go. So, like, this is how everything was before today. Yeah. And then this is just what one additional light has changed. And it's like, that's a huge difference.
It is. Yeah. It looks great.
Right. So I feel like we're finally at the right number of, lights on everything.
It is a fucking constant battle, man. Like it is one thing after another. And you know, it's like whenever you think you have, you know, it's like, oh wow, like now we have this like kind of little like stopgap lighting solution for this, and then it's like, all right, well, we have the labs and the labs work, and then the labs don't, but then you have these other things, and then that works. And
yeah, they just sounded super bassy. I don't know if I don't know why.
And that might also it just be a board thing that I can fix,
right?
That they're just more sensitive and I got to tune them in a little bit better on the
The labs, I mean, it wasn't that they sound bassy. They just didn't have much pickup. They'd have just very short range. There was no high ends or anything on there at all, which is very muffled.
Right.
So, you know. Yeah. And that is also me not having any fucking idea what I'm doing with the labs. Like, so.
Dude, trust me, I can relate. Get ready to become an expert in audio engineering.
Holy shit. It's fun, though. You know, for the first time, this kind of, I didn't feel like I was bringing, you know, I didn't feel embarrassed to bring somebody into the apartment, you know, I felt good of it being a studio and not like, let's just shoot our couch, you know.
Dude, it looks great. I love the addition of that TV or the second monitor in the back for you to throw up logos and whatnot. That's very cool.
And yeah, the Chromecast error messages.
What was that?
Chromecast error messages.
When it would run out of patience and throw up the...
But you know what? And that wasn't even... Yeah. I mean, really, obviously, and that's a stopgap for just, you know, I can just fucking run a HDMI to mini DV thing.
Yeah. Right on, man. Dude, I'm excited. Look at us all growing up, being pros.
I'm not. Nothing's changed here. Oh, yeah. Oh, wait. I'm sorry. Something has changed here. I don't know if you noticed. I got my new Game Day shirt.
Oh, right on. Dude.
Oh, wait a second.
Right on.
Hold on.
Dude, please don't drop your trousers.
I was going to say. If.
All right. The zipper on this doesn't work so well, but.
Yeah. Dude, how cool was it that Chris said that your SpaceX talk would make it into the next version of the book?
All I can say is that, like, it was that part of, you know, how Star Wars conquered the universe. And George Lucas had said that, you know, he hoped that one day maybe one of the first people to go to Mars, you know, and go look for a Wookiee and, you know, go to colonize Mars, you know, would be a fan, da-da-da-da-da. And you're like, yes, this is the opening to talk about Elon Musk.
Yes, that's definitely the actual fact.
And then, but it never happened. And I'm like, what? You know.
So, by the way, Chris was very excited. You know, I was saying goodbye to him on the way out. He very much enjoyed the show and said he really wanted to be back. And he gave me a half smile, which is British for I'm so ecstatic, I'd like to come back next.
Dude, very cool, man. All right, well, look, I guess we'll I'm sure I got dad things I need to be doing.
Can I just say what was great about him?
Back for jury at 7 o'clock, so be back here and I'll be doing that shit.
Yeah.
Let me just say what was great is that he wasn't bored about talking about it.
Well, he clearly has a real passion for what he's doing, man.
Chapter 22. Whatever, guys.
All right. Beautiful. We'll see you guys. Shoot.